My name is Phil Staley, and I'm from the town of Eureka, I'm with the planning committee for a whole bunch of years, and we have an ad hoc committee down through Lake Town and Eureka and the surrounding areas, and there's two little handouts that I gave you this morning. One is the Polk County Association of Lakes and Rivers that we sent out to all of the Polk County Lake Association. There's 150 some members or something like that. We sent that out to them so that they could take a look at this thing and get back to whatever representatives there are. And the other one was a working paper that we agreed on, set up when this new moratorium goes in, when that thing starts out. These were some of the suggestions that we thought might be helpful and some of the criticisms that we thought were criticisms of the last one. So you can read those over and go where you will with it. And then the only other comment that I have to make is I've been to several of these meetings and been around, and I think that there's many issues here. We have economic issues that are being discussed. We have land issues, real estate issues, all these issues. But there's one issue that I think goes above all of the rest of them, and that this is a public health issue. And I think that we have to treat it more like a public health issue and make sure that we're transparent with what we have. And the information that's going to be funneled into you, ladies and gentlemen, here, make it as public as you can. Come up with some way that the public understands what is going on and understands the issues that you're up against. And make sure the public gets that information, because they're the ones ultimately that are going to have to pay the price one way or another for whatever decisions you guys make. And that's about all.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
My name is Randy Clark. I'm from Warren, Eureka, Township 2, and I left a couple of sheets on the table for you guys. This is probably, some of you already have these, but there's an issue here that is very, very plain. This concerns phosphorus in the St. Clair River watershed, and the other one I've got here that came out of the Tribune this week, it's urgent care in Minnesota concerning the nitrates. On the phosphorus issue here, you can see here, out of 19 counties, from Minnesota and Wisconsin, Polk County is the number one contributor to the St. Clair River watershed. Just a very good point there, remember. And then the second page in there is on the susceptibility of the soils that we have, and that deals a lot with nitrate poisoning of our water tables. This is happening all the time, every day. We were to allow these CAFOs to come in here and do what they want to do, it's going to be a hundredfold of what the nitrates are right now. But take time to read this paper that's put together with the other one, because it just came out this last week in the St. Paul, or the Minneapolis Tribune. And it's what's happening in a lot of Minnesota there right now, but it's happening here in Wisconsin, eastern part of the state especially. Nitrates are the biggest contributor there is to bladder cancer, thyroid cancer, babies born immature and anemic, and many problems that are going on because of nitrates. And you can't emphasize that enough. It's one thing you got to bear in mind.
Thank you. Anyone else? Public comment.
Mary Curran, Eureka. Just want to say that the moratorium that was put forth here seems like a dividing tactic. The lake and cabin people against the rest of us poor country bumpkins. So just keep in mind that I don't find it very helpful to protect shoreline if you're not on shoreline. And even those who are on shoreline are going to be sorely disappointed with 1,100 feet between them and a cable. And that's all I have to say. I think that is just not good enough. It's just plain not good enough. There's a whole lot of us that don't live in a cabin on a lake, aren't snowbirds, aren't any of that stuff. We just want to breathe our air and drink the water from our wells. We don't want this happening in our community. And the Environmental Services is tasked with preventing these kinds of things and protecting the environment and the public. And that's your job. So please do it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anna?
My name is Danny Carlson. I'm the Polk County Snowmobile Council. I talked to Doug Rowdy a week ago, and I'm trying to show you guys what we spend in the county as a Polk County Snowmobile Council. And this is just part of it. This is from July 1st to June 30th. Is, and we have more than this. Even this was just a quick thing we grew up yesterday. As you can see, equipment, this is right now is what's come out of our checkbook for this year so far, and we still got to July. All this that you see on here that's spent, except the $2,500, is spent in Polk County. That's why we're really crucial on keeping our funded miles trails open, like the railroad grades, and we're having issues all year round on getting cut off on private properties where we lose our $300 a mile on trails that we can't get through. We have two trails this year that we lost for the year because a farmer cut us off, stopped us. We had one a couple weeks ago stopped us. Lucky enough, he was going to cut it off till next year. We talked him into it. He's going to do it on another trial for another year. That's about 10 miles of trail. So we still got that one open. So just for your information, this is just a part of what we spend as a council. After July, I'll bring in a sheet what all the club members do, and to make this money to work, it's all volunteer. I will have a sheet for you guys what our volunteers do to make this money so we can keep up with this equipment and stuff. And we try and spend anything we possibly can. Fuel is $21,000 this year on grooming. That's just coming through on the tractors, and that's all bought local. Everything in here, right here, has been paid to these counties into the private people that are whatever. Osceola down at the Frontier Ag. We either buy everything from Frontier Ag that we can, and there's some stuff we have to buy the county, like our, we just bought a $74,000 set of tracks from one of our groomers for grooming. That was come out of Canada. We don't have any choice with that. If we could buy it in here, we would, but we have to buy some stuff out of state for our equipment. And every year we go through, and this is kind of about what we spend almost every year. We don't get any of the money. It's all turned back into the community for operations. And I will have, when Ben and I get done and my wife get done at the end of the year, we'll bring into the board what all the volunteers do to make this up, you know. And like a lot of these volunteers, we use our trucks all the time, and that isn't on here. We spend our own money for that besides this kind of stuff, or the clubs help pay for some of that. So I just wanted to keep you informed of what our association is doing to help the community out in this county. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Public comment.
First picture is standing at County Road C looking west towards Wandrous. It had snowed on Monday night, the 17th. We had about 3 inches of snow. This picture was taken on Saturday morning. That's why the advertiser is on the bottom for a date. As you can see, there's not a single fresh track on that for, well, 7 days. The second picture is a picture looking east, back from County Road C, looking back towards Amory. There's probably about 8 sets of walking footprints in that same period. Just wanted to show you that, you know, we hear all the traffic, and that just shows that it isn't being utilized as much as we hear, at least in that period of time. And if the master plan is approved for snowmobiles, there'll be time for both groups to sit down and discuss how the trail can be shared. So far, all we hear is how it will not work. In this whole plan, you know, this is a democracy, and a large majority of the people that went through the survey, the first survey, a large majority in favor of SA3.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Well, good morning. My name is Sam. I drove 2 hours this morning, and I told myself I was going to get a chance to present before the board, so it seemed like a good chance. I did come to talk about the snowmobile conversation here in terms of shared use of Star Lakes Trail. I'm previously from Amory, grew up, born and raised, full-time resident in Minnesota now. I come this morning with an opportunity to provide some context as a professional. So I manage the Carver County Park and Trail System in the West Metro, part of the regional, Twin Cities Metro Regional Park System. Manage about 20 miles of regional trail, 1,000 acres of parkland as a system, about 55,000 acres of parkland, about 350 miles of regional trail in the metro. The idea that pedestrians and motorized users can coexist on a trail facility is not only unprecedented, it doesn't make field sense. You could put whatever you want in a master plan. Doesn't make sense in the field. You can use the metro as an example or not. Because while I understand growing up in Polk County, there's some big differences. And I appreciate them. I'm a property owner in Polk County. I own recreational property. There's big differences. But it doesn't work to mix pedestrians and motorized user groups in the same facility. It's not possible to do it safely. So my question for the board would be, what is the county willing to take on for risk? Because I can guarantee you that when something happens, when a pedestrian gets hit, when a snowmobiler gets in a tangle with a pedestrian, whatever the situation is, the county will be sued in that scenario. It's a guarantee. They will look for the deepest pockets, and it will be a county issue. So, again, coming with the perspective of, as a professional, being in the space, it's unprecedented. Again, 350 miles of trail in the metro is not... There's not an operational model that I'm aware of that mixes pedestrians and motorized users in the same season to comments, again, professionally, personally, I would agree that, trying to find ways to bring multiple user groups together is a good thing. Public lands are there for a reason. At the end of the day, that's not always feasible because of some of these dynamics. So I'd really encourage you to think more broadly than under local interest. Look at other examples. Think about the risks associated with mixing these two user groups. It's more dynamic than just putting lines on paper in a master plan and putting concepts together. So those are my comments. Again, I would strongly urge you to think about the risk impacts and the risk that the county's going to take on if we decide to move these two user groups together. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Dan Winterhalter from Eureka, and I just want to respond to what was just said. I've ridden literally thousands of miles on trails around the states, and multi-use trails and so on and so forth. And there's always a risk, even between bicycles and pedestrians. One of the only things that can be done in the city, I suppose in the country as well, is lower the speed limit the Twin Cities use a 10 mile an hour speed limit, and that gives people some time to move out of the way, to shift and so on and so forth. I don't think that it's a good idea to have that kind of a mix, but for instance, having bicycles and pedestrians on the trail, even for that situation, those bicycles should come down to 10 miles an hour whenever there's a pedestrian around. I don't know if a snowmobile can even go that slow because of the clutch they use. But that sort of brings a little reality if you're trying to make this work between people, is driving a vehicle at 10 miles an hour worth doing? So that's just my thought. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Good morning. My name is Melvin Smith. I'm with the Polk County Snowmobile Council. There is president of the runners, the skiers, and the bikers on the trail. It's called the Scobie Winter Ultra. They do it for 160 miles along with snowmobiles. Snowmobiles can run alongside of them. They've done it for 3 years that I've found so far. I've just found out about it yesterday, so I'm looking into it more to see how many participants they always have. But they go from Rice Lake up the Wild River to the Scobie, which is 80 miles one way, up to Park Falls. And they run, ski, and bike. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, anyone else? Okay, we'll close the public section. We do not have another supervisor here. Okay, number 6, Mr.
Mole.
Good.
Mr. Chairman, on the Woodley Dam property, as we looked at it last time, with a question of taxing property on there, and it is taxing property. When it was taken, the amount still on the books for that property is $87,127.49. And that would be repaid back to that account then once it's sold. So it does lie in this committee, put it on for sale. So what I'm asking today is, do you want to move forward with the auction sale? The other component that was brought up was, would you want to entertain input from other supervisors on the possibility of using this property in another fashion? Or would you want to just move forward?
there's some highlighted sections that just kind of touch on a few of the bigger changes as far as seasonality.
Is the graph right here? Right there.
It is, yep.
Okay.
Page 7.
Page 10, the highlighted stuff would start, which is kind of the meat and potatoes of what we talked about last time. So as far as seasonality of snowmobiles, December 1st to March 31st, equestrians will be May 1st to November 10th. That's what's in the plan right now. Hit on the maintenance of the trail being 15 feet, we'll keep maintained 3-foot shoulder on the trail. Another important piece to mention is we don't really know what's going to happen with the groups that are maintaining the trail now. The Friends of the Stour do 99% of the trail maintenance, and depending on the outcome, they may stick around, they may not. So we could potentially be left with all of that maintenance falling out of the county. We put roughly $15,000 onto that. That's about what the Friends of the Stour spend each year. And that's all volunteer donations. So $15,000 and 500 potential staff hours that may need to be added if the Friends of the Stour reduce their role in the trail maintenance. Another notable part is special events.
What page?
13. That is 13. Yep. So what we have in there right now is special event permits will not be granted for any activity involving a use that is not authorized on the trail. There was some talk about special event, special use permit. As far as the DNR is concerned, as far as we're concerned, it's just a special event permit. So any use that's not already allowed on the trail will not be granted. Special events must be approved by the county and the state, in taking into consideration factors like safety and seasonality, that kind of stuff. So that pretty aligns with all the other special events throughout the county and stuff that we can help do.
Now that's a DNR permit, that special event, is that first?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So people kind of know that we didn't make it up. It's a DNR and territory.
It's a DNR permit.
Okay.
Speed limits were talked about. That's the end of the highlighted stuff. But speed limits were talked about. We are in the plan. We propose 10 miles an hour from Amory to County Road C on snowmobiles. 10 miles an hour. Safety, noise. Hopefully that can be mitigated with the lower speed limit. That's kind of the extent.
Added the alternatives that you guys selected last time.
Yeah, we're going to the public hearing on the 16th.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep.
Right. Yeah. So where would you add the speed limits? What is that?
Speed limits are in the operation and maintenance section.
Speed, just operation, so you have to be aligned.
just pulling that up. Are there any questions on what was already talked about?
On the horse field, May 1st to November 10th, that was November 10th because the deer hunt, wasn't it?
Correct.
So 10 miles an hour is the first section. Oh, excuse me, it's okay.
Looks like on the map, just over 2 miles.
Yeah.
Right.
Page 14 shows it. Signage, yep. Speed limits, particularly replacing all directions. Okay. Okay, so that was.
It was 50 miles an hour for the trail. It's been at night.
Yep. So then there'll be some equestrian signs that says two here put up?
Equestrian signs will be put up. Educational signs at the trailheads will be put up on how to, you know, how to respect each group and how to yield and, you know, whatever we end up doing, what the outcome is, it'll have to be a lot of signs.
Okay. Yeah, is there any other questions?
Brian, I can go over kind of an update on the hearing and the hearing process if you want.
Sure.
You guys had an agenda for the hearing, kind of a proposed agenda for the hearing on top of that packet?
Yep, on the front here.
Yeah. Just look at it. I don't know if you want to start with that?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, let's start.
Okay, so we just have a pretty generic agenda here. So a call to order, which Kim would handle, introductions of the committee and staff, which I'll handle, ground rules for the hearing. You guys have any specific ones you'd like? I mean, last time we had respectful comments, no applauding, booing based on the comments that are out there, that kind of thing.
We had like a 3 or 5 minute time. Did we put that on the notice? I don't know. 3 minutes, yeah, let's make sure that's in
the
notice. And then the sign up, so that'll start at
5:30,
that was in the notice.
Right, yep, so 6:15 is the sign up time, we're making public comments.
Yeah, there. So then basically the booing, cheering, and stuff would be what you.
Yeah, I'm just trying to keep it orderly.
Keep it orderly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is with the sign up that should help us a lot.
Yep, and so we went to Unity, Bob and I went there on Friday. And instead of last time where it was set up on the stage, we're going to have a table at the front end of the auditorium there, at the floor level for you guys. Same thing, kind of similar thing last time. We have a podium with a microphone and for the commenters to come down and speak. I heard there was some issues with hearing and that kind of stuff last time, so get you guys a little closer together. We have the opportunity, last time we did an audio recording. I have talked to the clerk's office. We could use this video camera if we wanted to, if you have that as a preference, or you can use the same audio recording equipment that we did last time. Yeah, whatever.
I don't know if we can use this. I suppose use this side.
Yeah, either way, it's fine with me.
Well, it's working good, isn't it?
Sure.
Yeah.
We can all check online and make sure it is. Yeah.
Yeah. let's bring it down there.
Okay.
I think so.
I think go with both. I mean, depending upon how late it is, you know, how much that'll
cover.
We'll catch, but if we done them both, we'd be covered.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'd be safe to have.
We secured law enforcement just in case, not expecting anything, but last time we had law enforcement there as well.
The comments or the protective?
Yeah, for both, I suppose. Anything else? I guess, like it says in the agenda, we'll give you the stuff that we've received for the public prior to the hearing for you to review for your next meeting on the 25th.
How many comments and stuff have you gotten so far?
Quite a few.
Quite a few.
Okay.
Couple hundred at least, just the last, since we set this up.
Oh, it's your last meeting.
So there is some interest.
What?
In case that isn't clear already, yeah.
Well, now if we're gonna have 100 or 200 people, should we be doing this with this food deal?
That's your call. Or somebody above my pay grade.
We've already noticed it, but I don't know.
I think this is the Unity High School, correct?
Yeah.
And there certainly will be space for people to use the judgment and spread out. We can check the high school, make sure that we'll have hand sanitized things there, and that's, I'll look into that. But at this point, I think the risk is low. We have not seen any, you know, outbreaks or anything.
So they had one Osceola.
Right, but we haven't heard of any of the county residents yet, so we'll monitor that. We can always adjust our schedule.
Osceola's tag Prescott, it's the same kid.
What?
It's the same kid.
Oh.
From Prescott to there.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman.
Yep.
I'll just bring this up because Ben said that my niece and nephew, their kids attended Osceola, and their work, he works for Wells Fargo and she works for the city of River Falls. They both quarantined and they can't work for 14 days.
Really?
Because they attended Osceola.
Oh, they had a day.
Yeah. So.
That's interesting.
There is concern.
So if you got a fever, stay at home.
Yeah, I'll try not to bring that to the hearing.
Any other concerns then?
All right.
Okay, so this is the one, we'll have a few more copies there too for people, I would imagine.
We sure can.
I would say we should have a few, very many people.
Yeah.
Not hundreds. A few are, you know, see how many have it online or on tablet or something. What? Take it?
Yes. I think
Come with your comments.
Okay. But I presume, I don't think it's a responsibility to make copies for everybody.
But it's on the internet, is it?
It's available on the internet.
Okay, that's where we're looking at it right now.
Yeah, okay. So then, if they got tablets like I do or whatever, all right.
So, no copies.
No.
No copies.
Safety.
All right. Any other questions? Well, Parks, Rex, and Dan.
I do have one quick little thing. The Cattail Bridge RFP has been posted online. So that'll go up in the paper. Just want to let you know.
The Cattail Bridge.
The Cattail Bridge redecking in Avery.
Oh.
That's right in town.
Right in Avery, yeah.
Okay. Any other questions on that? Let's see. We were gonna have our...
Go ahead. I guess it's a damn question. How long till we know if we get the grant on the Atlas Dam? I mean, is that months out yet? I mean, it was 2 weeks ago.
We should see an award letter by June.
By when?
June.
Oh, okay, so June timeframe.
Okay. And then on the park rec plan, that's still being worked on. We'll put that back when we're caught up here a little bit.
Yes.
To review.
Yeah.
Well, we have some... 7 and 8 where they are?
We have not. I jumped ahead.
No, but did we do 7 and 8?
Yeah, and 7.
Should we do 8 at the same time?
Maybe. We'll see how the game goes.
Okay.
You guys want this up on the screen while I
present like
900?
Yeah, I think like, just as good.
Sorry for jumping around a little bit here. I guess after today we'll be 7% on it, so we make a good progress. The reason I chose to jump ahead to 900 is simply from the standpoint is this will be a new chapter associated with the 15-year plan. This chapter did not exist with the previous 15-year plan. In light of everything going on with recreation, I felt that Chapter 900, entitled entirely to recreation, was kind of justified. The reason we're talking about 900 prior to 700 and 800 is kind of some outcomes of what we discussed today will kind of influence 700 and 800. So that's the reason why, you know, I wasn't trying to confuse you or anything like that, but thought it was justified. A lot of this has been covered with discussions in the outdoor rec plan. A lot of this stuff is mentioned within that document. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on some of them things. As we get towards the end of the document today, one of the things that we're going to have to spend some time on is ATV use. Currently, the forest is open to ATV use on designated trails. That would be my recommendation to keep it that way, but the larger planning effort will be in consideration to the whole county. The county forest would be a piece of that puzzle, and that is going to be part of what we talk about today. We'll get to that, and we'll go till 10 o'clock, and then
about 5-2, yeah.
Okay, and then call it quits. All right, if we start out here, one of the things that's becoming apparent to me, I'd be on page 4 here. You know, as the outdoor rec plan and also the forest plan here are being updated, there's a lot of things that have been incorporated in both documents, and at some point in time here, when we get the 15-year forest plan done, we're kind of going to have to take a look at the forestry and park ordinances. So I don't know if that fits towards the tail end of the remainder of 2020, and that'll probably carry over into 2021 there. It's on my list to have a discussion with Malia on also, because there may be special language that we have to insert within this document to make them effective immediately until we can get the ordinances updated. So that's why it's basically entrance and user fees. There's not a whole lot of changes with that. I provided you a copy of them. Within the forest, there isn't a whole lot of user fees. Those do get analyzed per se every time the budget. Those user fees are included with that. I guess within the forest, the biggest one would be the firewood permit, and that is $8 a cord. Last year didn't sell much due to the blowdown, but on an annual basis, it's bringing in anywhere from $700 to $1,000. Basically, it's tied to what the going rate of oak stumpage is, and most of the permits are issued in the Australia. Again, those are reviewed on an annual basis when we budget. So, moving down to the next line items here, just looking through the forest plan and all that, my recommendation would be is there's kind of a handshake, has been for many years, associated with the Governor Knowles horse trails. They pretty much operate them. But the horse trails in the town of Sterling do traverse Polk County forest lands as well as the town of Sterling lands. I guess I'm working on signing more of a formal agreement with them. With your permission, I guess I'm asking is, I think that's the direction we want to go, is give them that agreement to use those trails for equestrian use. It just makes it a little more solid of who's doing what, etc. You know, they're taking care of the maintenance up to this point. I don't think we have a problem with Gov Knowles continuing to use some trails. I guess this is up for discussion, but my recommendation would be to formalize that and come up with more of a formal agreement versus a verbal, yeah, it's okay. I mean, what are your thoughts on that? I guess that's the way I'm moving, and I just want to make sure you're aware of that and you're good with it.
Would you have a memorandum of understanding?
Exactly.
Okay.
And that same principle would tie with Sterling loop that we have. Out in Sterling, it's just over 5 mile loop. That traverses Polk County forest lands as well as the town of Sterling. If it exists, I can't find it, but same type of thing. I'm working with them with the MOU, and I'm assuming you guys are good with that.
Whose trail is that? Is that Sterling's trail?
Yeah, the Sterling ATV loop. It's
Sterling, the town of Sterling is responsible for the transport.
Well, see, that's the assumption I'm assuming we are, and that's the whole purpose of these MOUs, is to outline who's doing what, et cetera.
But the assumption today is that it's a Polk County trail?
That's my assumption there. Again, I can't find anything that outlines just that. So this is an opportunity to define that, you know. I did go to a town of Sterling board meeting. It was in November, I think, and they support the trail. It's just outlining who's doing what.
Are the ATVs and the horses on the same trail?
They cross, and there is about I can jump to that now. Hang on. So basically, if you look up on the screen, this would be the ATV loop, and this here would be the horse trails. So they run right here for, what is that, a quarter of a mile, and they do cross in various locations. So
I'm fine with it. I think it's a good deal for everybody involved, and everybody knows where we stand as a county, and the town, Doug Knowles, everybody knows where they stand.
Because
it's in County Forest and Sterling, all the land, isn't it?
Correct.
Brown is Sterling, the green is County Forest.
I'll go back to the map here. So basically everything in green would be Polk County.
Polk County Forest in green. Gov. Knowles would be in brown.
Which is brown?
Governor Knowles State
Forest.
So, I mean, there's approximately 7 miles of that 30-mile trail that are traversing, and we're good with that. It's just outlining it so they can continue operation, make investments, what have you, improvements, take care of the signs, so we know.
Yep.
Okay, back to page 5. I basically mentioned the ordinance again. Let me get back on track here. You know, ordinance that I referenced at the beginning of my discussion here. It's just, again, as I continue to update this plan, it's pointing out. Can't have a separate ordinance and update this plan and then ignore that, but.
Do we know how many ordinances there are applying to this?
The information that I can find is about a 4-page document that is specific to forestry, and then there's another document that is 2 pages. And what exists is very good. It's just the world has changed a little bit here. We need to reflect that. That's you know, the information that's reflected in both of the plans is simply out. So at some point, we need to revisit that.
So we have to, because we're updating them all too, so we should, and codify them, so we should, correct. Can we do it at the same time?
So I guess I'd like to get through this and then get this approved, and then we probably need to immediately start with that.
Yep.
So,
yeah.
You know, here's another example. This is all good. This would be in regard to, I believe it was Resolution 5817 that would be here. That's just incorporating that resolution, 5417. That's just incorporating that resolution into this plan. And that was a change in allowing hunter deer stands to be, they can remain in the woods overnight if they put their customer ID number on it, etc. So this is just incorporating the resolution that was passed in 2017.
So when you reference that, you have that display that weighs orange paint, but you don't have that in the first one. Right. So it's what the time about?
Yeah, it's a question I have, and the more I think about it, I don't like that, because the reason I put limit the time was, given that it's public land, we don't want hunters per se putting up a deer stand September 1st, or when's this allowed?
Yeah. September 1st to January.
September 1st and January, through January 1, and kind of staking that as their own fort. But with that said, there's nothing precluding anyone from putting a tree stand up right next to the, I guess it hasn't been an issue, and it's just something we're not to pay attention to long term. It's not a problem today.
Okay.
I have taken down deer stands in February, and this is the enforcement tool to do that.
Oh, sure.
You know, I leave a card if they want it back, that's fine, but I don't get any calls. So.
I'd just say, too, but where it says, you have to have that 1 foot of blaze orange, you need that on these other ones too. Do we have to reference that, or is that by statute?
Well, that would tie to hunting blinds.
Okay.
Not the deer stands.
Okay.
So all I'm doing is inserting a resolution that was passed in 2017 into this document.
Okay.
Of which needs to be tied into our ordinance. And what I'll say about fishing, picnicking, hiking, they can do it anywhere in the forest as well as horseback riding. I'm not going to go into a whole lot of detail with that. the existing policy with camping is basically you can do it. Anywhere in an undeveloped part of the forest, if there's a boat landing, Apple River, you need to do it by, per se, permit. You self-register, etc. Anywhere else in the forest, you can just go camping. Well, what I'm starting to question, and this is going to be a balancing act, because what we're trying to balance is we don't want to have folks declare a residency out on the forest. So we do have the 14 days, so that's enforceable. But short of me seeing them camping out there to start the clock on the 14 days, I don't know unless I see them. So what I'm thinking is, and this is up for discussion, but my recommendation would be a simple call to the office and just leave a message, hey, we're gonna be camping here. That way it starts the clock on the 14 days. Right now it's a little bit too loose, where short of me finding them out there, I'm just thinking if we had someone who decides to live out there and, okay, now I've got to find them, and then the 14-day clock starts, and then I can
This puts a little onus on them to call and say, because then if they're there, it doesn't matter how long they've been there, right? I mean, because they didn't call and say
they're correct. I mean, and I can say, well, you need to leave, you're more than welcome here, and then I can start the clock.
Yeah.
I think it's we just allow it, and there's no permission required today. I think a simple call and
The only cost would be a call to your office to say, we're going to be camping on this chunk of ground.
Well, you certainly can't be going out to the Barrens every day.
There's
17,000 acres to cover, so.
So it just make it easier for me to avoid someone from living on the forest.
Sure.
So. You know, and I'm trying to balance that with the hunting crowd who, you know, they may pull a pop-up camp or whatever and go grouse hunting.
Yeah.
I'm just asking to call.
We'll start back on this after a public hearing.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, we're going to take a 5-minute break and then we'll have a public hearing.
Go quick.
All right. I guess we have the recorders on. Is the recorder on?
Yes,
yep.
Yeah.
All right.
No, there isn't. We're back.
So, we will start the public hearing. I'll read this yet. For Storage Solutions LLC, requests a conditional use via Article 8E6 of the Polk County Shoreline Protection Zoning Ordinance for additional storage buildings and relocation of outdoor storage areas. Location, 1494 State Highway 35, Lot 1, CSM Volume 4, Page 5, Section 24, Township 34 North, Range 18 West, County of St. Croix Falls, Parcel ID Number 0844-00579-0100-4.55 acres. So let's start out with our staff report.
Okay, so this property is located just south of Centuria on Highway 35. And so here's Centuria, County Road I, coming over to the courthouse here. So it's roughly about a mile and a half down. It is currently being used as storage buildings. There's currently four buildings out there that they have, several large ones and then a smaller one. So the use of the property really isn't changing. However, in that, they're building more buildings in that. And when they do that, that triggered the conditional use because it was beyond what they had originally applied for on their conditional use. So in other words, their old one was for four buildings in that. This one would be building the fifth building in that. And we would have outdoor storage. And the outdoor storage area that they're proposing is 40 feet by 380 feet. The proposed building is a 40 by 240, so that's very similar to like this long one right here. proposing that to be in here with the outdoor storage back here. There's no wetlands or floodplain or any navigable waters on the property. The property is zoned shoreline general purpose because of this pond, which is to the northeast. It's actually across the road. So there's no direct drainage into that pond either. There's no sanitary system on the property, but there's not a need in that because there is no waste created for that. The town was notified of this request and they have not filed any objections to it. And the county has sent out the proper class two legal notice to the property owners within 300 feet. And we have not received any feedback from any of those neighbors, either in support or objection to this request. With that, I'd like to get into the photos. So this picture here, I'm standing on the driveway and I'm looking to the west. And right here in that is Highway 35. This here is at the same spot, basically on the driveway, and then going to the east, quite a ways in that until there's any other roads or traffic. It's very small. The property is gated. You'll see several pictures of that with a open wire mesh chain link fence. This is the gated access. Highway 35 is over here. So here's the 140 by 240 building that they've got right now, and then there's another one behind it, and then there's this building back here. So that's the three. Here's some outdoor storage that they've got right now for campers. This here is actually a keypad or a gated entrance that people need a code in order to get inside. Just of that keypad.
Would you go back to that last picture? Right there. Now where that building is gonna go is where those units are parked outside. Now this is to the east. Is there enough room to put that new building up? Plus have that outdoor storage before you hit the lot line on the east?
Correct.
Yep. It doesn't look that big.
So roughly, if I go back to the GIS map here.
Well, how far would it be from the east side of that big building to the lot line? There you go, right where you're at there. There.
It's 180 feet, roughly, and that from that existing building over. And that the building that they're looking at, the building would be right in this middle gap here where they have all those campers and stuff right now. And that would be a 40 by 240. And then the area that would be outdoor storage would be back here along the line. So, yep. So it would fit. And then, so. This is kind of looking that other way. So this here building is a building that's right over by the property line, and that which is kind of by these trees back here. That would be the property line. So if we look at the aerial, that building that we're looking at is this brown one right here. And that, these are the pines that would be pretty close to the property line. So just some extra photos. Here's that building in the back. And that's also 40 wide, so that new building would be just up to the north or towards me when I was out on site in this area. Just a photo of that one building. That's what I've got for pictures. And that's all I've got for the staff report on this one. So.
Okay. The runoff would go to the south. Would they do a plan for that?
Correct. And if they're going to be exceeding that much impervious, but
existing outdoor storage be relocated, and the building will be where the existing outdoor parking is.
All right, does anyone have questions of the owners? Have you had anybody, neighbors?
I have some questions, I'm concerned.
Well, we'll give you time.
Oh, sorry, I thought you said neighbors.
No, I'm asking that.
Got it. I'm here, I'm objecting.
So you've had no troubles or anything?
No.
All right.
Apparently we might have a problem.
Okay, we'll find out. Anybody else have questions of them? All right. Anybody else? You guys can sit down now for a minute. Any comments or stuff? We want you to come up and sign in.
All right. Can you do that? My name is Leslie Boris, and I am the owner immediately to the east of this property. Thank you. So you guys, I guess my only concern about the property is the lighting, okay? I am the farmhouse directly eastward of that property, which is my house and my backyard. And I don't remember if it was last year or the year before, they built that bigger building to the south, okay? Not on the property line, but in the center there. And to the east, the lighting is extreme, you guys. I don't know how many lumina is coming my way, but it's like 10,000 lumina. It lights up my whole backyard, especially when it snows out and it reflects off the snow, you guys. It is so bright. So, years ago, that was also a concern. I came before the board, and when they built the property on the northeast corner, we presented it, or I talked to the board, and they said, okay, when the buildings go in along the east side, there's going to be no lights on the east side facing me, and therefore they built the building with no garage doors facing my property. You know, it's just a thinner building, and they come in from the west side, and that's great. Can they build a building like that with the back of it that faces me with no doors, no lights? They can still have maybe the storage in the center, but as far as them building a building in the center like that, you guys, and then put the storage on my side, the lights are going to be even closer than they are now, and the new lights he's putting in there are so flipping bright, you guys. So that's my concern. I mean, I realize it's their property. I'm all for people doing what they want on their own property, believe me, but it does affect me as an owner to the east, okay? And really, that's my only concern, is the lighting. That it's like living next to Holiday Inn over there. So if we can just minimize that somehow, that would be great. And I would have no objections to him doing any more improvements or whatever. I know that really, you guys, he might be running out of room though. There's a ditch. You know, I don't know, he's starting to jam stuff in there. I don't know if someone wants to go and look at that before you pass that, about building another huge building like that. But really, I'm okay with the building, but can they build it the same as the other littler buildings so it doesn't have any lights shining in on my property and me? I guess that's my only concern.
Okay.
If anyone has any questions, great.
Okay. Nope. We're good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? For, against? That could always possibly be a condition.
You know, I'm thinking of storage buildings I've seen, and they always put this light. I mean, I know they want to be protected, and they put lighting down the side of the building so it wouldn't be shining to the east. Couldn't they put lights down on the east side property line and shine on the west, and it wouldn't affect the neighbor?
Or one smaller
better.
Well, that's a straight up. It's a fence. I mean, the best scenario would be build the building like they did the other one. I mean, that way they would match and they would be good.
make a comment?
Yes.
The county's got to be pretty careful about outdoor lighting, because in the shoreline area, that there is actually state statute that says that we have very limited authority on outdoor lighting, as far as being shielded and stuff. So I don't know if we want to have the owners come back up and maybe they can, you know, present what their lighting plans are to you guys. But as far as making conditions on outdoor lighting and that, the county's very limited, unfortunately. There was a change in 2017, 2018, Act 167, I believe. And that, because of, that's basically a free-for-all right now. So maybe the owner can come up and say something, but I would discourage against conditioning the actual lights themselves. So.
Okay. Well, let's have them come up and see if they'll address this.
So currently, the lighting plans are the same as the lighting plan on that newer building that was built to the south. That could theoretically be changed to some degree. I'm not sure exactly how much that could be changed. We'd have to bring that up with our contractor and determine how much that could be. But we could take a look at it and see if we can minimize the effects of that for sure.
I think that's the ultimate decision of the committee, in that because when we look at our conclusions, and that the maintenance of safe and healthful conditions, and that, you know, any possible human health risk, that kind of stuff, I think that you guys could say that, you know, no lights on one side of that building, and that, but as far as regulating the actual outdoor lighting itself, to say it's got to be screened, otherwise, and that it could be denied, you know, and that based on those light issues as well, completely. But if you guys wanted to just say no lights, you know, on the outside of the building, for example, you would be able to do that.
Can't say it's me, but we can say no lights at all.
Pretty much. Okay. They could say no lights on the east side, though, correct?
They could.
And that's what I'm after you guys.
It's just hard to take and limit the type of light that, and, you know, that whether it's screened or whether it's blue or red or, you know, any of those kinds of conditions.
Okay.
The issue was, I believe in that, is that people had problems similar to this in the shoreline area where somebody wanted to have a security light out in their yard, and that's where the state statute came in and said, no, you basically can't regulate that outdoor lighting because they're allowed to have. Whereas I think if we're limiting based on what side of the building or any exterior lighting, you know, and that, then you're more regulating what type of building it'd be. But they could still have a security light separate.
Well, I guess I could go along with it if we have no lights on these.
But
they
could still have some security light.
They could still have some security light. We can't prevent them from that.
Yeah.
Some reason you need those bright lights. I mean, they've got to be bright if they're going over to his house.
Right. The reason the lights are bright like that is because we have a security camera system out there. And the security camera system obviously doesn't work in the dark. So in order to be able to see with the cameras in the night when people are most likely to break in, we have to have lights on. And they have to be fairly bright for the cameras to actually be able to make out what's happening.
So, Jason, could we say no lights on the east side of the building, but that would not preclude them from putting up a, for lack of a better explanation, a yard light on a pole and face it towards the building to the west?
Correct.
And make that light go that way.
Correct.
That's legal.
So I think you'd be fine. Yep. You just don't want to say no lights, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
They need security lights for sure.
But if they can get it so it faces west. Way of my death.
Yeah, it's a ruling.
A ruling.
Uh-oh, now we got a problem.
Are they have to get infrared cameras? A whole 180 feet. Can you communicate with 30 inches of? Just take off.
Then they make their.
So just for residential uses, so.
Just residential.
It's for what, rental?
No, just for residential uses is the outdoor lighting prohibition, so.
So you wouldn't be able to regulate or prohibit outdoor lighting if it's strictly for residential use, but because this is a business use, you could, as a condition, put some conditions regarding the lighting.
Oh, we could.
You could.
Oh, okay.
Couldn't we go back to Brad's suggestion?
Screen lights or something so they face.
They have to be on the east side, spray to the west.
Yeah.
Shining to the west.
You'd have to, if you put up yard lights like Brad's talking.
With.
In the back end, the east side should be shielded, shielded, right?
Right, yeah, that, when you said yard light, I think of the old.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
I'm looking at a spotlight that shines to the west.
Yeah.
More so.
Yeah, something that keeps the light from going back to the east again.
Yeah. And you want to cover your area anyway, not the other.
Right.
So that would be the worst. So that might be a condition that we have to, for the veteran holders.
Yeah.
Does that seem too hard or not?
It kind of depends on how much that would cost ultimately. We would have to end up running the power over to where the light would be, and there would probably be a difference in the cost of the light, so we'd have to look into that. But fundamentally, I don't think we would be opposed to that.
As a concept, no. It's just a question of how much would it cost.
Right.
Or if you had street lights that just went straight down. Give it something
they have to do. Yeah, I think, I guess I'll say, I don't care what kind of lights it is. It doesn't have to be the yard light scenario. It just needs to be something that does not let that light flow to the.
And
to the
ultimately,
east.
We have no real interest in lighting his yard, so.
Yeah. But I'm getting it anyway.
Right.
I mean,
right.
It's
But I think. I mean, that's my ultimate goal, is to keep the light from this building out of his yard, and yet
say in the net that if you guys want to put that as a condition, you definitely can. We would allow them to do a 40 by 380 foot area along the east property line, and that would be whatever they propose. If they wanted to expand it going towards the road there, and that would take another CUP. So, but I mean, if you guys want to put that as a condition, you can.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, just something.
Yeah.
Jason, would you like me to dig and read something for you?
Yeah.
To approve application on condition that any exterior lighting on the proposed building or outdoor storage area be shielded or directed in a way to prevent any light from going to the east.
Okay. So, how is it?
Word.
Okay. So, is there a second? Questions or conditions? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Right. Opposed? All right. That will be done. Do you want some findings? You're going to write it in there for us?
I'll pass this around so you guys can sign. Some of the findings that I had wrote down kind of off my staff report. Property is 4.55 acres, zoned shoreline general purpose. The proposed use is to construct another 40 by 240 foot outbuilding. The outdoor storage would be roughly 40 by 380. There's currently four existing buildings used for storage and other outdoor storage on the property. There are no floodplains, wetland, or navigable waters. There is no objection received from the town. And there's no sanitary system on the property. I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, but just speaking it along.
So then the only comment was lightning.
Correct.
Okay. Just so that it is as graphic as it is.
well as what we've heard at the public input, public comments, we have put together a team. It's actually a cross-division team. We have representation from community services as well as environmental services. Specifically, like Jason, Eric Wojcik, Tanya, Brian Kaczmarski, Steve Geiger. We thought we'd be proactive here, and collectively within that team produce a document that's specific and comprehensive to Polk County regarding this issue. So in one way to look at it, we'll have something tangible, a report that can be used to guide decision making, can be useful for the towns, can be useful for the general public, and available. And so, believe it or not, we've been kind of working on it as we go. In fact, to show you through the report outline, Jason here, he's going to compile all the presentations, all that's been delivered until now, and put that into the report. We have four thematical items we'll look at. We'll look at groundwater, which both Eric and Brian Hobbs are drafting. We'll look at impacts on people's on surface water, public health and safety, and then air quality. And again, I'll share with you that we're working at now. Actually, there's a nice little draft coming together. We're also going to include all the current policies and procedures that could be included in each section. Unless you want, we're going to withhold any recommendations. We can include that in general nature, but right now we're just focusing on impacts of CAFOs and within those four key areas. I also will do a literature review, so we'll have citations or references to all the research in there. So it could be looked at on the research-based document. Again, it'll be specific to the soil types and Polk County environments. So that's what I'm sharing with you here. I think because of everyone's work up until now, we can have this available for your first review of draft at the subsequent meeting, which is March 25th. And that's something that we can hand out to you for you to read and consider. And then we're also prepared to provide a formal presentation as well, if needed, either to this committee or as the moratorium extension resolutions states, you know, we can provide that to the
Where do you think this is going to go, Bob? Because I think yesterday in health, I think Malia said that you can't do away with them.
Yeah, well, you know.
I mean, what are we just beating a dead horse?
We have limited tools. I mean, they're highly regulated by the DNR, Wisconsin DNR, as we've noticed, the St. Croix County Board, sort of reaching out to the DNR to look at them. No, we don't have a lot of control. I think what we're hearing from a lot is from, you know, the zone towns. And so they're looking for guidance for their, you know, land use decision making. And so we're providing a product for them. And then there's a lot of, you know, confusion and misinformation or just, you know, lack of information out there. So we want to provide something to the broader community as well.
So this will be, Bob, if I understand you right. I mean, just kind of an overall of what the county has done to this point. Here's what Jason's done. Here's what Eric's done. Here's what health has done. Here's what whoever has done it. And here's what we've looked at to get to where we are today.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
It's just compiling and just putting a framework to everything that's looked at. We're looking at some new things, but it's really, it's a comprehensive look at those top four topic items, again, groundwater, surface water, air quality, which is really limited, and then of course,
first meeting.
Conditional use was about.
Well, you bring the stuff, bring what you got the 25th then.
We're just, we're being directed by the, you know, the resolution to extend the moratorium. Some type of formal or informal presentation.
You know, what's odd to me is we can't shut it down or do away with it, but we can pass a moratorium to prolong it. And that's legal evidently.
And within that moratorium extension of the resolution was land use policy with prohibiting the shoreline areas. So that's pretty huge. I mean,
yeah.
48% of counties within shoreline.
But Mr. Chairman, we are still looking at conditional use.
Correct.
Right.
So I mean, there are some things we can do to
control. That's the
that's
our limits.
Yeah.
That's what we started with, to see where we can even
slow it down. Yesterday in health too, there was a siting bill going through our assembly. Well, there was a couple of words that they didn't like, so that kind of stuff. They
didn't make it at all.
No, never got out of committee and that's it. But the other way, that's something we were talking about, the siting. But there again, we can't be more stringent than
they are.
The state. So.
But you have to have the five different things that we had to do. Like cost share if you do the second and stuff up to 60%. So that's why we went with the conditional use on our first one to step on that. We got more control on
that. You know, I think these capitals would not be a problem if they were like the five that we have, locally owned and operated. When you start having people come up from Iowa, where's the money coming from? China? You know.
Yeah.
Because we've got, the five we've got are no problem. I'm sure you've never had to deal with them.
I mean, we don't have any open violations in zoning with them, of course, because we've never really regulated them before, so it's hard to compare, you know, and it's hard to know if they're making an impact on groundwater or surface water or anything like that. But this report is just intended to take in. There's been a lot of public comment, like, you guys haven't done anything as a committee, and staff hasn't done anything as far as any research or studies or anything like that. And this is made to just really put that information out there, because there's been a lot of staff time spent on this. We have been thorough, but we haven't been very transparent, evidently. And so this is hopefully going to increase our transparency to the public and be a working document for the county to go off from for maybe other stuff and that. So, I mean, there might be other options in that come before the committee, you know, or other uses that might need a report similar to this that we could refer to this for, so that we don't create mess that time.
So, do you think you're going to have it by our next meeting?
Yeah, I'm really amazed that staff, they're quite far along with compiling all this.
Okay.
So there's just a few other things we need to do. We just wanted to share this with you and, you know, by any other direction, I think we're on a good path. And, I think we can adhere to this time.
Okay. That sounds good. I think when we get to that one,
I'm the one behind.
He gave you too much today.
Mondays, Jason, Mondays. But that would, I think we get that draft decided if we have to the full board, so it doesn't get, we don't have to get the same presentation a bunch of different times or something, too.
That would be an efficiency.
But I think get it out there, I mean, get it to us and go to the board. But get it out there so the public can see it online
and that kind of thing. And then, you know, have a presentation in a month or something like that.
Yeah.
So that people have had time to
read through it.
Take in what's in it, you know, other than hand it out and here's the presentation.
Great idea. Yeah, we thought that on the 25th, we deliver it to you. If you guys are satisfied with it, we'll be out there online and available. And then there, there'd be a period there where people could comment, and not formally, but you could definitely elicit that. And then however you want to deliver it, either with the county board.
It's just that, it's just kind of ideas right now at this point. That's the last thing that we actually went to that public hearing, if you will, on. So.
Okay. So there again, I think getting that document from the 25th out there for people to.
To respond to.
Yeah, right. But I mean, get it out there so people have time to.
It's got to get out there.
Yeah.
Even if we get responses on email and phone.
Yeah, well, we need to decide then if we want to do this, the county board or have a public hearing or something, or have a bigger room there.
We might want to just have our meetings to let people know and approach us too.
Sure. That's what I'm saying.
Before we go clear to the county board.
Yeah, but I'm saying, need for a presentation to just.
You know, just.
Yeah. I'm not saying present it with a resolution.
Then they can come and discuss, I mean, public comments, they can express their new opinions.
Sure.
So, yeah, we can talk about ways to disseminate that. But you know, parallel all this is still the work of this new community, so.
Yeah.
So that's still going on as well, just on different tracks.
Okay.
And for right now, let me just be clear, you guys want us to take and hold off on providing any recommendations, correct? Or would you guys like to see some suggestions or ideas if they were linked to a particular finding in this report? On ways to.
I'm shaking his head no.
We'll talk about that.
I would put them on a separate sheet.
You see the product and then if you think you don't, the staff just provide recommendations.
I think anything like that should come after everybody has seen the report and it's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, it's there and it's been out there for 3 weeks or a month or whatever to take in what the report says that they've actually done.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
And then we go through a list and then what we can't do, we can't do, we'll find out.
Look at Polia smiling.
She just goes. No.
What are we capable of?
Yeah, what can we do? What can we do? Do we kind of look at it that way too?
Ooh, the boss is coming.
Yeah.
So you can't prohibit them.
Okay.
Right, but you can decide where they can be. So. If you recall when we were talking about placing it in just Ag 20.
Just Ag 20.
So all we are required to do is to create a space where it is allowed, right? Doesn't mean you have to allow it everywhere. Right now, we have no regulations on it, so it's pretty much wide open, right? So that's, it's not that we have no ability to regulate them. What we cannot do is say they're not allowed in Polk County. That's really what our limit is.
How about your conditions?
Right.
Is there anything in there? I've read some of those. Can we make them do a bond? Can we make them do some of these things
so
to protect ourselves?
When you're looking at conditional uses, if you make them so onerous, right, that there's no way they could comply with them, you're really prohibiting them, and that would not be legally defensible. We have to also make sure that we're not trying to regulate beyond what our state already does as far as putting those limitations on them, but then there's, so that's the conditional use side, right, and then there's the siting. Conditional use would only apply to places that adopt county zoning, and siting would be countywide. So those are the main differences between at least where they would be applicable.
So the 9250 and siting law would be countywide, no matter if they're zoned or not?
Right, right. It's not a zoning ordinance. I mean, yes, you're regulating location of a particular land use, but it's not considered a regular zoning ordinance.
But that's the one they have to go up to 60% cost share, isn't it? The same to make it compliant. Mm-hmm. That was in there, I guess.
That's the good thing about a conditional use through a zoning ordinance is the requirement for cost sharing. I don't know if you're right at the 60% or whatever in that, but that is that there is no requirement to provide cost sharing for meeting the criteria or the conditions in a zoning ordinance. So.
And you could incorporate some of the siting concepts right within the conditional uses as far as
setbacks and that kind of thing. So at least for those parts of Polk County that are within county zoning, you could incorporate the underlying concepts of siting, at least to some extent, in a conditional use.
There's a, we'd have to make a list, we'd have to go through again, right?
Right.
What we could do, okay.
On the zoning side for the conditional uses, I mean, and that the list of what you can do is definitely going to be much larger than what you can't, and that there's not that much that you can't do or you can't regulate underneath the zoning side, but it's kind of the opposite for the siting. You're going to be much more tied to ATC P51 and the exact criteria underneath that administrative code. And that, so that's going to put in maximums, and then you can't be any more restrictive at the county level than that code.
They,
so,
okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So there's trade-offs, but then that wouldn't apply county-wide, and this one's only going to apply in the zone areas. So.
So that's more of what we're going to get discussing right with here, with the zone discussion. On the next line.
On B.
On B, because of the in shoreline areas, then we have to amend our. So we want to amend that before we pass all this? Is that what I'm looking at? Or
no, we would be amending it for the resolution that we passed last month.
Yeah.
So I think that can be accomplished fairly easily, just as a general provision underneath our shoreline ordinance. And when it comes up, basically I just added one provision as a general provision that the expanding of a swine animal farming operation to 1,000 units or more within the shoreline areas would be prohibited. And that's all I basically added in there. And that, but then because we have animal units, we don't have that defined in the ordinance yet, then I had to provide the actual definition of what an animal unit was, which was what was on, well, what we talked about as a group on that sheet with the conditions, and that I had it defined there, basically it comes from an administrative code. So I'll pull that up right now.
Well, we're going to use the same animal units at 51.
Right.
Yeah, we'll use the same. We just have to refer to it in our code so it's in there?
Correct.
Okay, so that it is, that we're using the state criteria.
So, just added animal unit defined means animal unit. Let you read it. Basically, goes back to the administrative code 43. And then this is our general provision section. I just added N. Expansion of a swine farming operation to 1,000 animal units or more shall be prohibited within the shoreline area. So that would apply across all zoning districts. So this is the proposed draft that has our 12 zoning classifications like residential and ag and commercial in the shoreline area. And because of all those uses being different, that's why I put it in the general provision, so that it would apply anywhere underneath the shoreline area. So it's very similar in that up above here we have, you know, the use of phosphate fertilizers is prohibited. So just kind of a general use. I didn't take and actually call it a swine people in that because we don't have that defined, and we might have other spots in this ordinance that we talk about swine peoples directly. So just for right now, I think it was covered by not expanding over 1,000 animals. Questions on that?
No, I'm just looking to see. I got it here. I think that was the intent.
Yeah.
About the resolution. in there too, so we have all three of these? Is that in our?
No, that's gonna be in the subdivision ordinance, so that would be a separate amendment, but, you definitely could, hold off on having the public hearing and that for the subdivision ordinance, or do that, and then have another public hearing on the shoreline ordinance here, and that, if you wanted to at the same time. So it might be just a little bit clearer.
So because what's in this draft now, right, Jason, I mean, what, 4 months ago, we talked about putting other things in the shoreline ordinance that's in this draft, but hasn't been through the county board, but been through a public hearing already.
Yeah.
Would they also be included, I mean, anything in the draft would be included in a public hearing, anybody could speak on anything, right? I mean.
Correct. I don't think you have to hold another public hearing on the shoreline ordinance here, because it's already been decided at the county board that this is basically the text that needs to be in there.
Okay, so this could go right, we could, you could go to the county board just the way it is.
Just if you wanted to take and hold another one, because it's been a couple months now again, so, yes. And we had some comment in that, the last one about holding it in the middle, and that was in December, I believe, is when we held it, you know, and when everybody was down south, you might get a few more people coming back if it was in April.
But this is coming from a, from not the committee, it's coming from a county board, correct?
Yeah.
Right, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So then we would send this whole draft as is to the county board?
Okay, then we'd have, we'd separate out the subdivision one.
Yep, and that's gonna have to have a public hearing.
That's gonna have to have. So basically, we could send B up.
Yep. If you're okay with that text, or if you wanted to even change that text, I mean.
I'll make a motion to hold it on.
As is.
Yeah, as is, I think.
Okay. Does that seem problem with it?
Like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm so psyched about it.
Okay. So we're going to the full board, okay.
So then staff will file the report on the petition that was filed to amend this ordinance, and that, and what it would take, and we'll just, can you give that to the clerk, so that she provides that to you in your packets, so. As we're required to by statute, to give you that little brief report, so.
All those in favor to move it on, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Who is the second to sign?
Got it.
I had Edgel.
It was a tie, because I heard Jim and I heard Doug, and I didn't know who came to talk.
What an arm wrestle, Doug.
Now, do you have to have a resolution for this set to go to the board?
Yeah, I don't have that today, and that, but we'll have to get one.
Get one, and I can.
It'll be actually in ordinance, so.
Yeah.
Well, this won't make it to next Tuesday.
No,
we have to.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's in on the shelf for a while.
Yeah, so we can pull it down. Well, then C, are you going to?
Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
Under shoreline, I got a C, I talked to Jason, and he thought I could bring this up, which has to be brought up with the committee.
Under this, yeah.
Jason's aware of this, but Tom Hemmer wrote me, and it has to do with the trailer that wasn't removed with the nanny's permit. And his contention, he's got quite a bit of, he's got this whole letter, which Jason has, right?
serves this travel trailer. And what Mr. Haymauer was complaining about was that the fee for the seasonal travel trailer, and that you couldn't keep it there year round. And that, however, and that Tom, he had never actually pulled the permit to have a seasonal travel trailer there, so it's just been a violation on that permit. So now I believe Mr. Haymauer is looking to get an extension. Elizabeth already granted a 1 month extension to March 15th here, but he's looking to have it until May 15th. And then, so that he basically pull his seasonal travel trailer permit and keep it there the whole summer again, because our seasonal travel trailer permit runs from May 15th through December 1st. And as part of the comprehensive rewrite, the Citizen Advisory Committee opened that up a little bit more to allow for the seasonal travel trailer permit, because before in that, they were limited to 14 days on a piece of vacant land or raw land. And then you guys had looked at it a couple of years ago, and it used to be May 15th through September 15th, and it was extended to December 1st. And then we also put in a clause in that about if they have 40 acres or more of land in that in the ordinance. But this lot's about an acre or less in size. So so that's kind of some background information on it. Our seasonal travel trailer permit fee is $250. And then every other year they'd have to have a sanitary connection permit to connect to that sewer, which is $150. So you'd be at $325 basically on a yearly fee. So the idea behind it from staff's perspective as far as how much it is before it's placed out there, in the ordinance we have the requirement that it has to meet all of the setbacks for an accessory building, so we could have a site visit going out there for that. Staff could also have to go out there and that to verify the sewer being hooked up properly. And that, and also going out there and that after December 1st and that to make sure that it's removed. So, I mean, you could actually have three site visits involved in these. So, and there's a lot of complaints on them, so there's a lot of compliance time spent dealing with travel drivers. So.
Okay.
This letter just asked me to bring that to the committee's attention to the future. But he also states this. Last year with the tornado, when a bunch of trees were down, they had to get that cleanup done to get the trailer out. So I'm just saying, Jason has to make a decision on what needs to be accomplished this one. I did go look at it, and it's really steep coming out of there. Take Brad's biggest tractor to get it out.
Just in general, that's kind of one of the things that we've noticed is it's hard to get travel trailers out, especially on this year. I mean, I think the snowmobile trail is open December 16th, you know, and that's, so there's already snow early on. And once it gets snow and that, then it's hard to get them out. People don't want to take and drag their campers down the salty roads. And then a lot of them are snowbirds that go south, you know, so they end up hanging around. So.
Okay.
No excuses,
Jay. So that C, are you gonna add all these, or is that what you're looking for us to?
Just a little housekeeping within the subdivision
ordinance.
Yeah, right now there's a lot of language for just director, and we thought it would create some efficiencies if we just replace director with land information officer, zoning administrator, and or county surveyor.
Because it used to be that, like, Sarah McCurdy was land information director, you know, and that, so those were the kind of duties directly assigned to her, you know, and that throughout the plat approval process. And basically looking for, you know, who does the committee want to send a notice in that preliminary plat, like we had Foxwood here a couple weeks ago, you know, and that who should be sending that, and that, and then it goes all the way through, and that who's actually signing off on the CSMs that come through the door. And that, now I will tell you that Steve and that our surveyor still likes to take and sign off on those CSMs. That because he's checking them, and then for the survey requirements, he's making sure that they tie into our parcel mapping. And that, I tell you that currently, and that we work together very well. Basically, I do all the noticing requirements and that to get everything out. I'm checking the ordinance requirements to make sure that they're complying with all of our processes in the ordinance as well. So I think we could actually do a mix and match, if you will, if you just want to direct staff. I've actually got a draft in that created that I did this morning. And that if you wanted to see what that might look like. But you guys might just want one person to do it too, you know, so that's why we're bringing it to you guys, so.
Steve's okay with the mix and match?
Yep. It's basically that how we've been doing it as our department since Sarah McCurdy left and at the county, so, yep.
One name doesn't really cover it all, does it?
Well, that's the issue in that. So, I mean, if you take, and if you say zoning administrator and I'm, you know, gone for a month and then Hawaii, you know, and that, does that mean that nobody else is going to be able to do that, those duties?
Only the administrator can leave for that.
So that's one thing, like director was pretty vague before, maybe, that or land information officer, but that would still be probably linked to one person. We could do something more general, like in our addressing ordinance, and say something more like a county authority, but then that doesn't give the public a real clear person to take and send those documents to, you know, so.
A land information specialist, and then just use who's under specialist.
Good. I need to give him a title.
So I haven't ran this by anybody yet. It's in the draft in the ordinance here 33 times. And so it's only like in there twice and after actually signing off on the plat. But it's in there, you know, directing the director shall notify land and water resources 45 days before the preliminary plat comes to you. So then, you know, who's going to do that? You know, so that's what it really comes down to. This is really rough. But I just got rid of director and that and definitions for that person no longer basically there. I'm just going to show you a couple of examples.
Provides signature authority for the subject experts, the surveyor and the zoning administrator to do those subject issues.
And some
of it. Are divisional, but is it going to fit in there? One of your models that works, does it?
Okay. Good question, yes it does.
It does fit in, okay, so we're not changing that part.
Okay. And again, I'm.
It's just housekeeping.
Sure.
Apply the proper.
Right, and for like this one here, you know, and that before applying for approval of a preliminary plat, the subdivider or agent shall meet with the director, which is what it used to be. Well, this one I thought that they should probably meet with both Steve and myself, and then so I put county zoning administrator and county surveyor and other necessary staff, because if we have a stormwater erosion control plan, we might have land and water staff in there. So I just kind of went through this quick this morning, and I just made these changes, so. We don't have to go by line on this.
So just if you don't have to back up, but does that mean they would have to be with both of you because it's a zoning administrator?
And or could be a.
We need to say and or.
Yeah, because otherwise it's saying, at least the way I read it was you have to meet with both of them rather than just one of them.
Stormwater sediment erosion control plans. Probably going to be in our office to take and make that wave. This is probably another and or.
Yep, that's the same directive for reviewers.
Well, that one I'd like to leave it as and okay. Because of condos. So that both sides are reviewing it. So
both sides, okay.
Yeah. If you're okay with that, so
yeah, we,
we never used to really regulate condos in that, but a lot of times in that with these condos, Steve is going to make sure that they're tying correctly and that, and we might be involved in that for outlots and that going down to the water, probably access outlots and stuff, so it would probably be good to have at least somebody from zoning and somebody from surveying look at it, so. We file a lot of these documents kind of in zoning, or, I mean, it is in the same land information office and that, but, so some of these are just, I put myself or the actual zoning administrator for the county, because that's kind of where the documents are getting filed. This is like the direction in that to provide copies out. I'll scroll down here in that till I get to Steve. But like here, and that, any tie sheets to the public corners, you know, and that, that are required for each plat, you know, of course we want that going to the county surveyor, so, yeah. After the committee approves a final plat, and that, I have the county surveyor shall certify the approval upon the plat, so that's where Steve would sign off on the plat. And then just providing copies and that to the zoning administrator or our office and that, because we keep a copy of all the documents in our files there. So that's more paper record keeping type of deal. And then this here, and that county surveyor shall have the authority to take action on a preliminary CSM. So that's basically Steve can get the approval. Those don't come to the committee. So anyway, so this is kind of the way that you can do kind of a mix and match. So anyway, and I literally just threw this up just for some ideas today. So, but if you guys were set on having one person do it, that could be done.
Well, that meets our divisional deal too and stuff, wherever it's kind of lined up, it would make more sense to go at
all. Right, and like Jason said, it creates some efficiencies, particularly with the signature authority. There's two references to that in there. Again, Jason's not there, Steve.
Oh, and I mean, just simply, I mean, Jason doesn't work Mondays, so if it's done and somebody comes in on a Monday, Jason's not going to be here to sign, you know.
Or if they look at the surveyor, walk around the corner, go to the right person.
Yeah.
You know,
usually they end up waiting in that, I mean, on these plats and that, they weren't done overnight, so they end up waiting, you know.
Yeah.
So. We have a tremendous amount of time, you know, in that as far as our approval, you know, and that here you can see there's 45 days, you know, and that, so a lot of counties run at those, you know, 30, 45, 60 days, it takes that long. I'll tell you that while the plats can get drawn out, even on our plat approval process, we're much faster than other counties like St. Croix, and that, so they're probably using all their time. They have a lot more developments too, so.
Yeah, no, I think it makes sense that we will take it to some.
Mm-hmm. It gets into our mind.
Yeah.
You know, that we're trying to do so it's the right things or that we're not changing it. Yeah.
So we'll run this by staff. Like I said, I haven't had a chance to do that.
We'll make sure
I get Steve's comments on it, get Bob's comments. And then if you wanted to, we could actually set this for public hearing in April. So probably at the first meeting in April, if that would work for you.
Sounds good. Yeah, I just keep it.
It kind of goes with that with
overboard too. That'll help that divisional thing too.
Yep.
Okay.
and then I think he said to keep that off.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah. Old horse. You can even send one all the way around. I've even got one with you. Schickler. Any of this. So after comments from the last county board meeting, I wrote a resolution. Lily didn't like my resolution, so she said, bring it up every time.
Sure.
So this is, and have the discussion there. So, and let me preface this by saying, this is in no way, shape, or form trying to take agriculture out of the discussion of pollution. This is simply looking at other sources of pollution that come into our lakes, our rivers, our groundwater, our surface water, and saying there's more than one culprit out there. Agriculture is certainly a part of the problem. It is not the only problem.
Yeah, what did you like up first, Brandon?
Milwaukee sewer system. See, in 2018, the Milwaukee Sewer District alone dumped 1.2 billion gallons of wastewater into Lake Michigan and surrounding waters. So that's the equivalent of 142,857 7,000 gallon tanker loads, which is 1,948 miles if those trailers are nose to tail, which is from Superior to Miami, Florida, is 1,840 miles. That's one city in 1 year. Lake Michigan supplies water for 48 million people in the U.S. and Canada. It seems like a lot of sewage, and that's just one city that's coming in. Beaches are closed on Milwaukee South Shore 60% of the time. 30% of the samples in a 3-year period in Ashland on Lake Superior over the federal E. coli standards, and 34 million gallons of waste is treated daily in America. Okay, Jason. Next one.
Next page.
Yeah, next page. So as you can see, outside of Milwaukee in 2018, 338 municipal overflows, not counting Milwaukee, with 150 million gallons there. Just that 150 million gallons is an average per county of 2.08 million gallons per county across the state.
Is this just the state of Wisconsin?
This is just the state of Wisconsin. Now that averages 5,250 gallons of waste every day in every county in the state they dumped in. That 2 million equivalent is the equivalent of 391 mature cows standing in the St. Croix and the Apple River 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And the 2019 overflows, I believe that they didn't send me that information, but I do not believe this includes the city of Milwaukee, 361 million gallons, or an average of 13,700 gallons per day in every county, and the equivalent of realistically 1,000 mature cows standing in that same water, or if my conversion table is right, somewhere between 2,500 and 3,000 hogs standing in that water. 2-year averages are the 2-year total of 511 million gallons is 73,000 tanker loads, which equals 829 miles, which would equal half of that at 414 and a half, equals nose to tail on those 60-foot semis again. Superior to Madison, which is 328 municipal plants were built in the 70s and 80s, even though they've been updated, it leaves a certain amount of drug residue in the system that can't be destroyed by natural bacteria. If you look at the amount of, you know, go to the pharmacist sometime and see how they're dispensing drugs. As we all know, a certain amount of that is passing through us into the sewer system with somewhere between no way to get it out or a very poor way to get it out. And no tests to test what comes out of that, and tell me, for the pharmaceuticals, which comes out of the municipal sewer systems. It's largely dependent on the plug, the drug, the plant, and the community. So who would like a glass of water out of the gap? In comparison, agriculture spills in 2018 and 2019, which are not specific to CAFOs, this would be anything that was called into the DNR as a spill. So it could be something huge, it could be something as minor as some dry manure that fell off the side of a manure spreader bouncing down the road. It was 99 in 2018, 128 in 2019. In 2018, there was 5 for a total of 17,700 gallons of spills. 2 of them were broken hoses. And in these cases, everything that's available is sucked up and spread back on the field again. Most of them are closed by the DNR from what I can see. If the spill happens today, it's closed tomorrow or the following day. It's all cleaned up and spread. There's 18 counties in the northern region for agriculture spills. So in 2018, that averaged a simple 987 gallons per county compared to 2 million gallons of municipal waste. In 2019, there were 6 spills, 7,300 gallons for 406. And in Polk County, there was no spills in 2018 and 1 spill in 2019. So now we'll get closer to home. Problems with stormwater runoff, which leaves the towns, leaves the country, leaves wherever it is, ends up in the lake or river. Some of the problems, bacteria, viruses, and other disease-causing organisms, notably Cryptosporidium. Phosphorus and nitrogen in municipal stormwater runoff is a big problem. Toxic chemicals include motor oil, gasoline, grease, antifreeze, lead from grass and auto exhaust, zinc from roof drains, tires, and other toxic chemicals make ill aquatic organisms. Road salt mixed with stormwater is also toxic to aquatic life. Don't forget that one. Oxygen-abandoning materials that end up in it, pet waste, leaves, grass clippings, other litter. And organic waste can kill fish and when oxygen levels drop. Debris such as plastic bags, six-pack rings, bottles, cigarette butts, washed into the water bodies can kill or disable several types of aquatic life. What do we do about the nitrogen and phosphorus coming into our water from 17,000 acres of county land plus all state land, to say nothing of the nutrients that comes from private wooded land? And we'll get down to St. Croix Falls. St. Croix Falls is a land mass of realistically 4.67 miles of land, 0.11 miles, square miles of water. Realistically, in one inch rain that produces some over 81 million gallons of rain just in the city of St. Croix Falls that ends up in the St. Croix. Salt and sand use in St. Croix Falls over a two-year period was 146,000 tons, averaging 773 ton a year at roughly 80% salt, 20% sand. That's equals 2.1 ton per day, 175 pounds an hour, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. I think if any one of us went and stood on the St. Croix and started dumping 40 pounds of salt and 10 pounds of sand I'm wrong, Eric, there's no way to really know when we take that sample. We don't know if that's coming from the woods. We don't know if it's coming from agriculture. And we don't know if it's coming from municipalities or cities or lakeshore owners or a pound of phosphorus is a pound of phosphorus. So this, like I said when I started, this is not to say that agriculture does not have a role in this, because agriculture does have a role in this. I do not believe that agriculture has the only role in it. And if we're going to go down the road of restricting things that some can do, you know, I would hope we would look outside of that. We certainly have a couple supervisors who seem to be true environmentalists and people who show up from river associations that don't like don't seem to like agriculture, which is fine. But I would challenge them to go to the municipalities and say you need to put in a stormwater treatment plant. You know, the fact that it's going to cost you tens of millions of dollars. You know, I live in Glen Falls. I don't live in a municipality, but I do farm. It would be, you know, not my problem. So on to the pictures, Jason. This is just some pictures from a couple of communities around. Hit all three. Keep going there, Jason. As you can see, that's a snow pushed up next to a wetland full of salt and sand. There should be three on that one, right?
Yeah, they're all together here.
Yeah. Okay. That's the same one, and. Here, just back up just a second, Jason. Here we have a salt sand pile running into a wetland. I'm not insinuating there's anything illegal about that. I'm saying that the town that that's in, Mr. Marsden, any guess? The Village of Luck.
Yep.
The town chairman in the Village of Luck is Mr. Johansson, who's the county board chairman, who sponsored the CAFO moratorium, which is fine, but here we have a pile of salt sand running into a wetland with cattails. I'll just leave it at that. It is what it is. There again, I'm not saying there's anything illegal about it. I don't know. Realistically, I don't even care. I'm just saying that there it is. It, you know. He's the one who made the push for this, and it's his town that's running that, well, salt into the river. So keep going. So here we have five or six pictures, I think it'll be, of the city of St. Croix Falls piled up on, I believe it is, the Lions Park. You can just keep scrolling, Jason. So as I spoke before, there's no shortage of salt and sand used in St. Croix Falls. And somewhere here there will be a picture of, in fact, right there it is. There is the St. Croix River. So there it is. That's where the debris from that salt, from the snow piles is going. So yeah, you can. I think there's two left there. But I just bring this to the attention of the committee, and whoever's here to say it's a big problem. It isn't the problem of one individual group. You know, as we go forward, certainly no one group can fix all these problems to get the job done right. Everyone and everywhere in our county is going to have to pitch in. And I think we just need, and this speaks, this my speech here speaks nothing to shoreline, which is just as big as all of this, I think. So. If we're going to tackle this problem out there, that's where we need to be. Then, where you started, Jason, on Eric's clips. Is this the Polk County one, Jason, or is?
Yep, this is Polk. Yep.
Okay, scroll down all the way to St. Croix River. So, realistically, the St. Croix River is not impeded with phosphorus, it's impeded with PCBs. At least that's what the Department of Natural Resources website tells me. Then head back to, can you hit St. Croix County? Fine Lake St. Croix. And click on the right one of the two, that one there. Okay, go back, maybe it was the first one. Scroll down a little. There. Impaired water notes. I'll say, to me, I think this says a lot. It's impacted by phosphorus. But rapid population growth accompanying land use changes that have affected the water resources of the St. Clair River Basin. Based on a 39% projected population growth in the basin by the year 2020, water resources will continue to degrade under these circumstances. To me, that's saying the population growth and saying that the housing growth that's happened in the St. Croix Basin is as much at fault to the situation we're in today as agriculture. In 2013, or 2007, excuse me, they were not saying agriculture is the problem. They were saying we are the problem. All right, thanks, Jason.
For discussion, what do you think about 17,000 acres of land? Just for an odd question. I mean, how many different watersheds are county forests in? More than one, aren't they?
So the question is, how many watersheds do our county forests
are in, and how much do we think comes off of them?
Well, we recognize over 40. 12 watersheds.
Okay.
I would say, off the top of my head, we probably have 12 of those at county forests, and they're all contributing to runoff to the St. Croix River. I mean, we're
collectively,
yeah. Yeah, we're all in that Lake St. Croix basin, all contributing pollutants, phosphorus included, to the St. Croix River, and ultimately Lake St. Croix and the Gulf of Mexico. So, yeah, there's, without a doubt, there's impact on every acre of land we have in Polk County. So, I'm not disputing any of
that. And I think, just because I picked on that, when me and Eric were discussing this, I picked on a couple lakes. And I don't know, Eric, did you get a chance to see it? The Coon Lake that was on there is Coon Lake and Frederick.
It would be.
Okay, yeah, I wasn't sure, but I mean, Coon Lake and Frederick, there's no inlet, there's no outlet. Realistically, the water comes from the city. I mean, there's one field above, through the woods on top of a hill. It's been an A for, I think, my entire lifetime. The other one, Doug will know, Ward Lake, no inlet, no outlet, right, Doug? Is there an inlet or an outlet on Ward?
No.
So there again, they're both on the
impaired list.
On the impaired list, but there's nothing coming in, there's nothing going out. I mean, other than natural rain and the surrounding area, and I'm not even sure what the agriculture would flow into. It's been a long time since I've been by Ward Lake, so, but it would be relatively minimal, I believe, would it not?
That's pretty minimal.
Yeah. So that's my point in this whole speech, is if we're going to look, we have to look everywhere, because one, saying agriculture is going to solve the problem isn't going to. Saying forestry is going to solve the problem, it's not. Saying municipalities are going to solve the problem, it's not. So I could go on, but I'll stop.
Just a part.
Just a
Municipalities can work on the problem, because we have water that runs here, knows that probably, runs from the west down to the east along 280th, and it used to go through Irwin's Pond, come out through his cow yard, and into Ward. Now that water's diverted to the north. So
out speech of mine. But it also goes to show that, that the lake is still, I just have to respond. But the lake is still high in phosphorus. Even 10 years ago, the county, the state, whoever came in and diverted a bunch of that water that was going to go across Irvin's, you know, and moved it out of the way, and yet, you know, it's still high. The good side of Wood Lake has been taken off the mercury list, so.
Well, it's good to know so we don't get tunnel vision, is basically what it means, because we're not just stuck on one thing.
Well, you got the theory of the speech.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's take a short break and finish up forestry. Okay.
Did you have a question? You were talking about this camping.
Yep.
And I might, I'm from that area, Brad's from that area, but there's county land along W to the south, right by the Clam River family. But the reason I might be mixed up is because you've got McKenzie and you've got this county land. I mean,
yeah,
they're
that whole
area.
Yeah.
But it seems like it's a gated county land there.
Yeah.
And I mean, it should be, we can go camping there, it should maybe the gate be open.
Well, the reason that gate is there, we'll get more into that in chapter 700.
Okay, that's the way.
But what that is if we're talking the same area, that would be both the Stonefield Trail and that's where the logging access. So we'll get more into detail in chapter 700, but the reason the gate's there is so that people are driving pickups back there.
Yeah, so you're talking, and maybe I misunderstood you, Doug, but you're talking right on County Road W.
Right on W.
Okay. Yep.
So, yeah, the reason that the gate shut is you're including the damage. You drive a pickup in there, you know, this time of year through July, you're going to be across.
Oh, I know
so,
that, but.
I mean, that's why the gate's there, so.
It just, I think, I mean, if you can drive a camper in other places, you can't go in there.
Well, I'll just say, because I've been in on the snowmobile trail there in the summertime, it's a very good thing it's gated.
Okay, that's fine.
I mean, it's truly lowland, and I mean, yeah, you would, in a drought, you would get stuck in.
Yeah.
There's
ash. The reason that it is county land from years ago.
Yeah.
So we left off we agreed that we're going to keep the limitation of camping to 14 days and permission will be granted by way of phone call versus nothing so far. So basically they can just go and do it today versus they need some type of granted permission.
Yeah, I just have a question as to why it's 14 days.
It's an ordinance tied to parks and forests currently. So for consistency,
okay.
I implement
no, that's
it. It's avoid people from setting up their home.
Yeah, no, I know, but I was thinking like, you know, why wouldn't it be 7 days? But as long as it's consistency.
And that's up for discussion. I kept the 14 the same, and that's consistent with Apple River Campground. So that's kind of what the ordinance sets today.
200 gallon containers.
That could be 10, 7 if you want it.
Yeah, well, no, I'm fine. I like consistency.
Can those travel trailers be parked 14 days without a sewer system and water?
I don't know, unless I really don't know.
Yeah,
they don't all have.
That's why you have the 14 days.
Yeah. And then that's part of it.
That's part of it, too. That would fill their reserves.
Yeah.
Then on that last line on that paragraph.
I fixed it.
You
so
fixed
basically,
it.
Depending on what we decided with the permission, I just deleted it.
You just took that half permission out.
Yeah. Because we skipping pages.
You know, if we
who
don't.
Who came up with trout?
I'll get back to that. Let's do this.
Okay.
What I'm trying to do here is, you know, I've been to these public meetings just as well as you folks, and I've heard the public express the need for ATV trails kind of off of the highway system that we kind of have today and the limited railroad grades that we have. I hear the need for off-road ATV use loud and clear. With that said, however, the county kind of lacks a comprehensive approach to what we're going to do as a county. And the forest would be one element of the whole picture. So basically, just to get you guys thinking, I'm asking a series of questions here because I don't necessarily have the recommendation either. But what I want to guide you towards is some comprehensive thinking of, number one, is this even possible to add a enjoyable ATV network in Polk County given our public ownership and our railroad grade system? Just asking the question. And it all begins in what are we trying to accomplish? And that's why I'm at the point of, you know, I guess I would give the recommendation that ATVs do in fact need to be allowed on designated trails only. If we choose to open up the entire county forest to ATVs, I'm going to have a disaster on my hand. Because I'll have nothing to enforce. They can go anywhere they want. And if that is written in an ordinance, there's nothing I can do about it. There's nothing that can be shut down. So I guess what I'm asking the group here and challenging the group here is, how do we transition from this step of railroad grade by railroad grade to a comprehensive ATV trail network? And bear in mind, just by the nature of the sport, we're talking miles and miles and miles. It's not like a walking trail where you can develop a system in a 5-mile stretch and you can appease a lot of recreational users. Just by the sheer sport of ATVs, you're talking at least 100, 200 miles worth of trails to appease, to drive tourism, bring economic development. Well, the snowmobile clubs have been able to accomplish that mission because all the crops are out, the ground is frozen, they can get those easements, and hats off to them. Since the 60s, they've been working on this, and they have developed that wonderful trail system that Polk County now has. Bear in mind, if we're talking any type of summer ATV trail network, there's crops in. I'm asking, before we open the entire county forest, that we implement some type of comprehensive trail plan. And that's what I'd like to write in this 15-year plan. This is up for discussion, but that's where I would guide you, I guess. So.
Well, if you can run almost every road in the county, why do we need a trail system?
Because nobody wants to ride on the road.
Yeah. And that's up for discussion.
So yeah, I don't think we've had any accidents, have we?
No, but I mean, it isn't, you know, it still isn't. When I ride on my dirt road, it's no comparison to when I hit County Road I or 80th Street and ride on the blacktop. I mean, everything is way more touchy at that point. But I love the idea, Mark. I just don't know that it's feasible. I mean, we look around, and most of the county land is in the northern portion of the county. But even in Sterling, it's tied in with county land, town land, Governor Knowles. And then when you get up in mine and Doug's part of the world, it's, you know, Mackey Lake is tied in with the McKenzie Creek Wildlife area. Yep. You know, which is, you know, the town of Sterling might, but the Department of Natural Resources is never going to allow it.
Okay.
So, you know, and th-
say, here's where you can go, go make the trail. You know, I mean, this isn't a, to me, this isn't a county budget issue thing. It's a, if you want to go make a 20-mile trail, a 50-mile trail somewhere, that's, you know, that's fine, but the group has to do it.
Okay. You know. Let's, on the maps that I handed out, let's go to page 4. Yep, and we'll get more. And this is why I'm doing 900 first before 700, but I'll just use this as an example.
So are we in Johnstown here, Mark?
Just so I'm looking at the...
I'm on McKinley.
McKinley. So the question that Supervisor Rowdy had asked, why don't we have the road open up just south of W? So... The point I'm trying to make here is the county forest is part of the puzzle here. So 270th is open to ATV traffic. So we go through all this effort if we want to do MOUs, etc., and allow ATVs on that blue highlighted area. Is that doable? Yes. But who's going to invest the $50,000 per mile to make that usable year-round for ATVs? This particular stretch that I'm referring to, we struggled until about mid-January to get this frozen down to allow snowmobiles.
So, trust me, I know.
Yeah.
And I don't know.
So that's why I'm suggesting, you know, this is part of the puzzle, but are we going to be the leaders in a comprehensive ATV use land plan? Or at some point in time, it's like maybe we've done the best we can. I don't know the answer to this, but this is all up for discussion.
How long is that trail? Would it be a couple miles?
That would be
3 miles.
3 miles. And both this particular trail is gated on W, and it's also gated on 270.
What are the dotted lines there, Mark?
Those are temporary roads.
So this should maybe fall into maybe our rec plan as goal way future, incorporated in here that we would use county forest land if usable. You know, like when you read some of this other stuff, are the soils right, wetlands, all this.
So I guess that's why I'm number one guiding the committee.
To work both of these together.
To keep ATVs on designated trail board.
Correct.
And then at a later date, we can, in this comprehensive, if we choose to go that way throughout the entire county, this can be a piece of the puzzle.
Yeah.
Where if, yes, the ATV council, we procure a grant or whatever down the road to make it usable. I guess I'm not going to close the door until, but I'm trying to close the door on it until improvements are made.
Yeah, because like it says, it's for long-term sustainability and everything through these swamps and everything.
Should you be getting a hold of the Luck Club? I think they're the biggest one in the county, ATV Club.
There's quite a few of them, but I think they don't have
Well, that's what I was going to say. But we can't do it. We're not going to quit.
Mr. Chairman, maybe I could answer that for Jim. The administrator was gone on vacation. Brought in Public Safety and Highway, G.
talking about the resolution that Jay Luke asked.
About public safety in Iowa.
Right, and again, I'll reiterate, I think it makes more sense to have that resolution brought here. I can certainly see why there's some overlap, but, you know, deciding which committees get to take the lead on certain things, you know, it just to kind of keep it in the correct lane, but certainly...
Well, I understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
I'm just saying Vince has to talk to Jay, and you can talk to him. It's got to get coordinated.
If I may, I think we've had discussions now over the past several months about a comprehensive recreation plan.
Yeah.
ATVs, snowmobiles, walking, bike, all those things will be important. I think you alluded to the cost of such, just the ATV portion. Part of this whole comprehensive plan, as we develop and move closer to that, is that once we lay it all out, as a county, we can decide what does our county want to look like? Do we want to be, we can't be all of it. I mean, wouldn't it be nice? But we can't be all the things that everybody's going to want. So you can then prioritize. Is it going to be ATVs? Might, but it might also be fat tire bicycling, or it might be walking, or anything. So I think if you're asking for some preliminary guidance, that's great. If the ATV clubs are looking to make their mark, that's great. But I think you get a committee, they should feed it into us as we develop the comprehensive plan.
So it should go into our rec plan, and that will add into the forestry plan.
Yeah, to summarize, if Polk County decides in a comprehensive rec plan to concentrate on ATVs, what I'm suggesting is out of the 17,000 acres, we can give 17 miles of dead entrance.
Yeah.
Which may help answer the question.
So,
yeah. Are you going to be an ATV camp?
Well, Summers Lake had a dead end trail, I mean, 15 years ago.
It's another example.
Yeah. You know, it's a half a mile from Eye to the lake, and
yep.
you could travel there and take a one mile four-wheeler trip, half mile in, half mile out.
Yeah. I mean, just one more example to bring home the point. Flip to the very first page of West Sterling.
Which one?
The very first page. It's labeled West part of Sterling. So if you look at all the roads are colored, whether it be blue, orange, or dotted black, you know, the solid black would be all the township roads that are currently open in the town of Sterling, two ATVs. I guess if we want to make some parallel trails to the township roads that are already open, we're looking at, instead of having a 5-mile loop, I guess we could have a 15-mile loop. When I hear discussions on Burnett County, the Sawyer County, well, Burnett County's got 110,000 acres of public forest land. Sawyer County has 400,000 acres of national forest in their background, and another 150,000 of county forest land. Well, there's a little more opportunity there.
Yeah,
so
that's a destination.
That's a destination.
Yeah.
And they have the logging roads and stuff that are built. That have been converted. Yes. They're dual-use logging roads, ATV trails.
I guess to me, I'm not sure where it was. It was before the 10 o'clock cutoff there.
Mm-hmm.
But it was, I think, somewhere in there. Did you not have the, you know, groups could come and ask about MOUs, to use, and I think, at least for me, that's the biggest thing. It's out there. Everybody realizes if you're a hiker, if you're a biker, if you're a four wheeler, okay, it's out there. Come see Polk County, and maybe we can work with you. You know, in some instances, maybe we can't. You know, but
perfect.
Let's have the discussion, but. I guess let's leave it up to them to come to us and say, okay, you've laid this out there, you're giving us the opportunity to have a trail. So we're gonna, you know, then I am, as that group, I'm gonna come to Polk County and say, okay, I want a fat tire bike trail in the Summers Lake Recreation Area because it's like this. Okay, biggest thing so far, and I'll say that I've seen, is we're opening it to everybody and saying, come with, you know, or come with an idea and let's formulate a plan off the idea.
So I've convinced you to keep it on designated trail.
Yeah.
And these questions are good ones to ask. That's what we should ask anybody that comes in.
Yeah, and I mean, if you want more information, more maps, what have you, I'd be...
We got it right there. I mean, 90% of it's dead end.
But I would be this and...
There's no way we can just open it up and say there's 17,000 acres per acre. You know, I mean, if somebody rides up a trail in Sterling, does it really matter with the four-wheeler and back out again? No, not really, but if, you know, 300 people are riding up it every week, you know, on an undesignated trail, that makes a big difference. You know, so, yeah.
So what I'm...
All those roads in Sterling open?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, there's a lot of miles there alone.
Yep. Yep. And all the Polk County Forest has, back to that map, I can scroll back up there. This is the entire forest. The only place ATVs are allowed is right here. Entire forest.
That's the only off road.
On the entire forest.
Yeah. The rest they can do all the roads up there.
On township.
On township roads, yeah.
But I mean, if somebody chose to, just looking at the front page here, I mean, there's a possibility for a lot of miles there. You know, sometimes you got to be cutting that corner exactly right before you really touch it.
And there is. I mean, best case scenario would be a 20-mile loop, but there we go again. It's a closed loop.
Yeah. I have to drive there, and I have to load and go home in 20 miles.
Yeah, or take the county highway to the township.
Right.
It'd be a nice side excursion for those people going from, say, Curry Falls up to Burnett County. They could, if they wanted to get off on a side road or something.
And so, Ben and I are, as well as Chris Nelson, are part of what's called Nordic. So this is a consolidation of counties in the northwest part of the state. Could Burnett County change their mind in the future? But just to the north of Sterling Township would be Anderson Township in the town of Sterling. Burnett County has not developed any ATV trails in the town of Anderson, and I asked the forest administrator why. No one lives there. All their business is further north of Webster. So as of today, even if we did, there's nothing to connect to as of today. I mean, it's all this part of a bigger planning effort that is going to take time if we choose to go that direction.
And there again, then, I mean, Burnett County has to be willing to go in that direction at the same time, really, for it to pay for us
to move forward.
I mean, if all of a sudden, if we can have 20 miles in Sterling here and tie that in to Anderson, I think you said in Burnett County, and maybe tie that to something else,
then that's a different equation.
Now we've got something.
But
you know,
as of today, Burnett County's emphasis and development is Webster North. Could that change? Absolutely. So,
okay. I think we have designated these questions, kind of ask if somebody wants an MOU to start a walk a trail, bike, whatever.
If someone did approach us that they wanted to sign an MOU with us in the town of Sterling, our guidance is going to be, we'll do one, but you're going to find the funding, and just so I'm clear here, you're going to find the funding, and we will allow it on designated trail home.
And it would have to, I mean, it would have to be, here's where the trail's going to be, you know, because, okay, and maybe there's no swamp out in Sterling, but
make a loop, go back to a township road, get past or over the swamp, and then right back to the port.
Yeah, I mean, I think any MOU would have to be.
Yeah, it shows it better up on that map.
Yep,
there.
I mean, lay out where do you want your trail to be, and then, you know, the county.
Sure, the
you
county,
know, county has
to see where
it
has
okay
to be. If there's already a temporary road, not.
I don't think it's just as simple as saying, yeah, I, you know, hey, Mark, I want to put a four-wheeler trail in Sterling and say, yeah, go for it. Here you go.
I'm good with that, but can I make a comment to that?
No, it's not as long as you're good with it.
I mean, the first question I'd have to ask them is, well, where are we going with this? You know, this is another closed-in loop.
Right, but that's where it has to be.
So
where's the trail going?
You know, and then another half a year, I get approached by the bike tire club, and they want the same trail.
First come, first serve.
It's just, what I'm thinking here, it's just, this is one of them items that I think, you know, the forest is part of it. Where are we going in the county with ATVs is a concept that I think everyone in this room is struggling with, so.
Well, I'm going to go back to my theory of before. It's laid out there for every group.
Yep.
So we are treating every group exactly the same. Everybody has the chance to come to the county and say, here's where I want to put a trail. And regardless of who that group is, I think if it works for the county, it's a good idea. If it doesn't work, then it's a bad idea. It doesn't matter who the group necessarily is, you know. And for one, and you know, maybe a 3-mile trail doesn't work for a 4-wheeler, but a 3-mile trail that dead ends, maybe it works for a fat tire bike.
Cross country skier or walk.
You know, I mean, you're in and out and. I don't know that it does. I'm just saying, you know, those things, you know, what's a dead end for a 4-wheeler, you know, the Summers Lake Chunk, you know, a half a mile isn't much, but maybe for a certain user group, it's okay.
Okay. So what I'm going to write in here is on designated trails only, and the forest will consider, you know, an MOU, as long as it can be maintained, graded, rocked, whatever.
Yeah, the user group is on the hook for it.
And I'm assuming that would take committee approval.
Sure.
Because you guys would have to walk it too, maybe.
Yeah.
So if you go through your bullet points.
So as a policy then, are we going to support closed-in loops, all of the above?
No, go right by your questions right here that you have highlighted. Trails should be, you know, planned to connect the communities. Loops discourage a partner of a larger trail that connects to it. Then trails not be sanctioned. Intense use areas not permitted. New trails won't be allowed if they fit kind of an established plan by the committee.
Okay.
And the trail is considered a suitable soil. 17.
Okay.
Sorry. I think if you went by those bullet points, that kind of covered those.
Okay. Then, so that's great.
Don't you think that covers us that way?
Well, if you like them, I'm comfortable
with
it.
The group can always make the case of we don't care if it's a dead end trail.
Yeah.
You know, and then maybe that, you know, maybe
so
maybe if they want to do a committee, and I don't know, but
if they want to ski to the 2-mile loop, maybe that's all I want to do.
Yeah,
I mean, but at least it just says discouraged.
I mean, to me, it's one thing to have a 50-mile trail that dead ends as opposed to a 3-mile trail that dead ends. That's my thoughts, but.
Yeah, and I don't know that this is the right answer to argue that point, because I agree with you. But I'm going to come back to, I think it matters who the user group is. Because 3 miles for 4 miles isn't
so that no.
The MOUs associated with horses, that was covered.
Yep.
Previous, so
yeah.
This
so no,
is
I don't think just ATVs.
Just
there's
ATVs.
No place to get 50 miles.
No.
That's it. I mean, it just isn't. That's.
And that's kind of my point.
So if we look at that with these, I think if you leave those bullet points,
okay.
Use for your discretion that way. Get up to the committee. I mean, your homes answered.
Okay.
These other things are not the same. Does that make sense
yeah.
a little bit?
Yeah.
If you had this criteria, they would bring it to us.
Yeah. So the only clarification I would need then would be on this closed-in type of stuff where we're going to support that, we're not going to support it. If I can clean that up, it'd be bullet.
Which one? That we're going to support it?
I took that one out.
Are you looking at that? So trails will not be sanctioned, is, or where?
It would be part of the discussion. It's not in here. I apologize.
It
would just be kind of a policy in regard to we are going to support closed-in loops or we are not going to support closed-in loops. That would be in addition to
2.2. Well, that would be 2.2.
So trail systems like this would be a closed
loop. Yeah.
So as a policy of the committee on the forest, we are going to support them or we are not going to support them in the future.
Bullet point two, we'll discourage them. Loop trails will be discouraged unless part of a larger trail system that connects to the community.
But there again, if another group comes in.
Nope,
yeah,
we deal
yeah.
with ATVs right now.
Yeah, no, but he's
oh,
talking,
okay.
Yeah,
okay.
But,
okay.
But so in, yeah, I mean, in on page one here, you
yeah.
could, in theory, get a 20-mile loop.
It's
I mean,
possible.
Are you saying we're against having a 20-mile loop?
I'm just saying discouraged, but they could still do
but
it. It doesn't say we're against it.
I have a trouble if a group is coming to the committee and they want to put in a loop. What's the difference? They're going to do it.
Well, let's just, we already did the horse one.
Or even if it's a dead end, and they say, well, this would be a pretty ride up here, you know, dead ends, you turn around. I just don't see why those are problems.
I think we're on the same page. But you're saying if the group comes to us and say, we want this 4-mile dead end in and out, wherever, you're saying, well, if they want it and they're going to do all the work, why are we discouraging?
Yeah. Or a loop, even. I don't.
What?
Because there's already a loop in Sterling. What would another loop? Why would we discourage another loop? Maybe they could
you
make.
Convinced me.
Maybe
I mean,
they could make it a figure eight.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Boy, you get away over
well, we're dealing with just ATVs. Because it's under that ATV section. So I think the bullet points just discourages it. Doesn't say that.
Just let them come up with it and then say, pull ahead.
Because it always gives, I mean, we always have the discretion to say no as the count.
Yeah.
No organs, yeah.
Well, right. But I
don't
mean,
discourage us.
Somebody can come to us and say, we want this 3-mile dead end. And we can say, yeah, no, because of swamps or one thing or another. Or we have the ability to say no. So I'm in with Doug. I think we should let that four-wheeler group who's going to realistically do the work and spend the money, I think we should leave that up to that group,
yeah.
if they want to do that.
Okay. So take out some of these bullet points?
If they're going to do it.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I don't know if we'd have to take any of the bullet points out. I mean,
no, I don't think so.
No, I mean, we can still say that we discourage it.
But we're not going to be against it.
But we're not, we're just saying we're discouraging. We're not saying...
No,
ATV club, you can't do it. We're going to discourage it, but come and sit down and let's have a conversation and see where it goes.
So on a closed loop trail,
we'd still discuss it.
It'll be allowed, but
we'll be discouraged, not allowed.
Yeah, discouraged, but allowed. I mean, I think that would be on anything.
But may be allowed. is, I'll incorporate what we talked about today, and this is probably something we're going to have to revisit again, so.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't disagree with anything, it's like, however, it's just part of me, it's like, okay, where we're going with these, to me, it's not really a trail, it's the beginning of something, I guess. That would be the first question I would have for.
I don't envision your phone ringing off at the hook, saying, you know, can I make a 3 mile four wheel or a 20 mile or a 3 mile dead end?
I mean, the discussions I've had with the ATV council thus far have been, can we open the county forest up? I'm like, yeah, but where are you going?
Yeah. They just want to go
It's like.
But I mean, this gives them the opportunity to say, okay, let's go figure out where it is that we want to go, and then come to the county, and maybe we can go there.
And, you know, I think the ATV council, to kind of say what I did at the beginning of this ATV discussion, I think they realize that they need to put together a comprehensive plan, too, with the county. And I think that's what people are beginning to realize, is that opening this county highway system was, you know, step A. And to get to Z, there's a whole lot of work to get done.
And I
agree with Mark, but the thing is, right now, the crews come and say, well, can we do this or can't we do that? And if the county's completely closed, it's like, I live by McKinsey, and there's signs that you can't have an ATV on there for nothing. So you don't even ask about it. So if they can't at least have it in their head that, maybe I'll go out there for a walk and see what's out there. They want to go for the walk.
And the other thing is I think, is, you know, as someone who, back in the mid-70s, kicked the snowmobilers up our property, I think there is that opportunity out there to be able to get them 20 feet on the edge of a field to shoot.
Could be.
Lyle, what do you think? I mean, is it, am I pushing it? I mean, just.
You wouldn't be on my farm.
the point being, there's a ton of work that needs to be done before Polk County can open up what I call a trail system.
But I think by giving them the opportunity to come and say, okay, can we go here? And then, you know, well, no use knocking on Lyle's door. knock on Lyle's neighbor's door. But, you know, maybe there is that chance. And, you know, maybe it's if I just go down the road, for me, where the snowmobile trail crosses, it runs all through private property, but I don't know that there would be a problem with putting four-wheelers in that three-quarter mile all-wooded stretch, you know, to get from one side of the section to the other. So,
yeah,
you got to start somewhere to end up somewhere. And so if you're going to get big, you usually got to start small.
Well,
there's no harm in asking.
Right.
And, you know, I'll just use this as an example. I don't know how long this system has been here. I know it's been in play for at least 10 years. Beyond that, I really don't know. But this is a start, too. It hasn't grown. It just demonstrates the complexity of making a comprehensive ATV trail system in the county. It's difficult. It's just, we have what we have. So.
Yeah, nothing's going to happen overnight.
Correct. Too much private land. Difference.
Yeah.
So I think
you
guys are.
If you're trying to roll around, Lyle might be willing to give up 20 feet.
So I guess think about this. I'll incorporate a couple of items that we discussed today. I'll incorporate the things that we discussed today, and then you good with it? Move on.
Yeah. Okay. Some of it's under trail maintenance. I'll go back a page too.
Okay. Now I'll go back.
But I think incorporated, and then, you know, it kind of back in front of us again before it's finalized anyway.
Yeah.
Okay. You know,
we do have a maintenance.
We can take another shot at it. Where are we headed back to?
So he wanted to go to page.
trout hybrid, what's a trout? Where do you look up that trout?
So a trout would be perfect for Polk County in regard to, if we wanted to take the highway system that is open, and we wanted to run across a county highway to get to Sterling, and we had a 20-mile closed loop. Assuming that the 20-mile closed loop was entirely on Polk County Forest, we could get funding for the 20-mile loop. But we would not get funding for the county road highways because they already get gas tax dollars.
Okay.
That is what is referred to a hybrid trail or a route or a trout, depending on which particular trail you're on.
I've never caught that 20-mile long trout.
Well, that, so why don't I bring an example the next meeting? I'm trying to explain this. And
I read it. It's
so the county,
it's gas tax or anything, we don't.
So the county highways would be a route,
yeah.
A designated route. If you flip to that first page where it's orange, I received gas tax dollars for that. That would be referred to as a hybrid trail. I would get partial funding for that. And then if we made a trail in the forest, that would be a trail. But the whole system is a hybrid trail. It's confusing, I know.
Plain as a path of the truck.
But,
well, just out of curiosity, Mark, I missed math here.
Yep.
These are what you're talking about. So how do you get from here to one of those?
Hence the issue.
There's no trail in between.
Hence the, we would have to have cooperation with the town of Sterling. So if you look on the map behind you.
So the white is Sterling, or on this map?
On this map, it could be the town of Sterling and or private. So if you refer to the map up on the,
okay,
on the computer screen here, I think that, I mean, the town of Sterling is willing to work with us. The white would be private, the orange would be the town of Sterling.
Yeah. White is private.
So in the case, the specific case that you were talking to, Jim, would have been the town of Sterling.
So you could,
it just does demonstrate the partnership with not only the private landowner, but different entities in the county forest. And
yeah.
Well, this go back to this trip here. Why would anyone want to go on it? And you start here, you go here, you end here, you turn around and go back.
Yeah.
That's my point.
Do we have any idea how much it gets used? I mean, it gets used by locals, I'm assuming.
The Sterling ATV loop, it gets used, I would say it's light use. It gets used, but very lighted.
Very light line?
Yeah, it's pretty rough.
I mean, I'll say this. There's fresh ATV tracks on it once a week in the summer. And that's the only time it's open, is the summer.
It gets tried some. But it's pretty rough. I mean, it's bumpy. Would that be accurate?
Absolutely.
Yeah. You're not going to go very fast. Gets ripped up the road.
And that's sand. It's you grade it, you have three ATVs drive over it, and it's rough again.
Yep.
Yeah.
But in this discussion, the Southern ATV group and the Luck ATV group, Lisa Anderson, she's had people contact her, and I've had people contact me, and I give them, the answer is, they
access to River Road.
When you get down to Wolf Creek. But that's the piece that is missing before you have a ATV trail. You know, and all this needs to come together. That's all I have.
That's it.
You're just getting warmed up, Mark.
Yeah.
So.
Hurry, I got a meeting in just a few hours.
So at the next meeting, we'll be going over chapter 700 here. We covered half of it for me, so.
Should we?
We covered half of it.
We kinda did.
See, your West.
Kinda did.
Your West Sterling is page one, my West Sterling is page last.
Sorry.
Took me a while to find it.
My bad. Was everyone's like that?
No.
I called it early.
It must be. My bad, I called.
Yeah, so we have.
Need a challenge.
Some sample.
You kept referring to page one.
Did we get through 7 and 8, or just 7?
So all we have left is 7, 8, and 10.
Maybe I bended.
And ten is what, and I've been handing out the maps that go in appendix.
So it'll be, by the time we get to the appendix, it'll be full?
Well, the other appendix I'll have to have, we'll have to get to it, is, would be the forestry and parks ordinances. Those are gonna have to be updated, as I mentioned earlier. But not crucial for what the DNR wants for October. Needs to be done, yes, but.
Okay. Most of the 700 will be good.
700 and 800 should go fairly well. I'll bring 800, if we wanna go over it, we can, that's. Not much to it.
Okay.
I think bring it, so.
Bring it, so, if we got time, we'll have to get it, so we're down to the last one.
And I'm sorry, I've yet to write 10, so.
Oh, okay.
But.
Bring 8, so we're there.
Okay.
Just fits. Okay. So we went back to 900. So we'll put 700 on our next one.
Yep.
800, 700, 800, yeah, let's put both on there, just in case.
Yeah, I'd bring 800 anyway to pass out, it's
yep.
Whether you guys have time to review it or not, it's
yep.
Gonna be the question.
We'll have the public hearing debate.
Yeah, the sour 700,
you know, okay,
that'll be after, we'll be after that.
Yep. I think tax delinquent properties, we should get a, Parks and Recs probably could give us another update on there, what they did on the rec plan. They have good links and.
Well, and they'll be here for the showers, I don't.
Yeah, we'll have enough, so they'll be, forestry will stay. So we will come back with this, with a draft for C on the subdivision ordinance.
And then they're gonna bring A, on 9.
Yeah.
Yeah, they'll be back with that one in the presentation, I think, yeah.
But that was just the draft at that.
The draft, I think, at that point.
About their review of all the material that is installed, yeah.
Yeah. That'll be coming. Always the divisional deal code, should we just put that on there, I think, or is, are they doing pretty good?
Yeah, they're doing pretty good. It, I don't know if it's finalized yet, but by the next meeting, it might be.
Oh.
I think you have to talk to Bob to make sure.
Okay, you throw it on.
Let's put it on, so maybe.
One of those times.
Your divisional breakout, would that be ready next week?
You know, we have maps and we made some progress. I could have put it on the agenda, but it looked kind of a robust agenda, so.
Yep.
We'll see it next time.
Put it on the next one?
I can, I will.
Okay.
I'll check with Mo, looking at tax delinquent properties, in particular the Woodley property.
That should probably be good, because we told him to put it down.
Yeah, so I'll see what time, the timeline is for that public auction, and if there's anything to report, if it's still gonna be, do you guys know?
No, go.
I'll check on Mo.
How much property have you got at that auction now?
That might be the only one.
Yeah, that's it.
Is everything else that is gone until tax? Oh, right, regular stuff, yeah.
Well, yeah.
So that would be, everything that we can get rid of.
Yeah.
Is gone. So it's not till June, first day?
After July, yeah.
July, yeah.
Yep.
That we can get back on, okay.
So I'll check with Mo. In terms of the number seven, Parks, Recreation, and Trails, one potential agenda item, well, it'll be the consolidation of all the public input.
Yeah.
Particularly from the survey instrument, which has been polled, as you remember from the last meeting.
That might be.
March 9th was the end of public input. So, and I will tell you just, I don't have the numbers for me, but that was a high participation at that poll that the county created, and it reflects your recommendations. So there's that.
Okay.
But we'll have that along with the other buckets of public input, for example, that third-party website.
Oh, okay, sure.
Products from the public hearing. So we'll have that to share with you. And then we might have some proposals from the Cattail Bridge. And Kim, you mentioned outdoor rec plan. We had two sort of ideas. One, we thought of doing a parks tour.
Oh, in the bus, here.
Just
okay.
To show you the condition of our county parks.
Sure.
We might try this instead. Ben's willing to create a little PowerPoint for each park and present it to you, and then if we need to go out and actually do the visitation.
Oh, sure.
So that could be like, you know, every subsequent meeting, just the...
Okay, he won't need a lot of space there for the summer slip.
No.
Well, then if we are interested in water, if we can do it on our own.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah, no, I like that idea.
Maybe we get an idea and then say, well, let's go, or, you know.
And maybe we could talk about our full county board. Maybe we'll just do the whole bus thing this fall. I don't know.
Yeah.
But we thought we'd start there.
Start
so
that, right.
Yeah. So in terms of that particular topic, I and Kim, we'll have Ben do, maybe Apple River, one of the...
We'll do a short update that, you know, some of those links and different things that were added to it. Even a short update, just so we know that they're on.
And then, I assume
Forest
15-year plan will be on there.
7-800.
7-800.
7-800.
Gotcha, thank you.
Yep.
And then, yeah, we talked about the CAFO report, so that'll be on there as well.
Yep.
We could bring the CUP, the work out of that, back to the agenda, unless you wanted to postpone the condition use permit for
CAFO.
Yes, sir.
We want to put it on there. Okay.
You want it on the next
we're
one?
We're on the next one.
For the
we want to do it after the draft, or do we want to wait?
You want
to
well, I'm just... He's spouting up a lot of stuff that's on the agenda.
Yeah.
You know, it depends. The trail thing could be...
Yeah, pretty long.
Lengthy.
So,
so if we just get the draft, maybe that's good enough.
The other can go into April.
Yeah.
We got two meetings in too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So the CP can...
Because then C has to come back. 9C.
Yep. Correct.
And that would be a draft too.
Yeah,
do a draft on that one.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so we could get two drafts and then it wouldn't be quite so bad. Okay.
And setting the public hearing for that.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, I'll bring a divisional model.
That'll show in surveyor, director, that stuff.
Yeah, we've
the model will fit.
Yeah.
Those, okay.
Yeah, there's a whole new model. still a robust agenda, but yeah, it should be too bad.
Yeah, we should be Monday, 2, 3.
We don't have to read the draft.
Don't schedule any meeting.
I don't, just this one.
Town board.
Okay.
Do you want the motion?
Butterfly. Oh, just a second here, what else? We got something. I got a whole other question. Did Lakeland send you, Lake Town, send you a letter?
No, well, I know I was CC'd on that, our office has not yet received it.
Oh.
Other folks who were CC'd in on it have not yet received a copy yet, as of yesterday, so.
Okay. So you'll answer it then?
I think it was addressed to the administrator, was what I was told.
I haven't seen it yet.
So.
County staff, but every supervisor's got it, but county staff, I don't think.
I don't know where you got it.
Usually in the mailbox, right there.
Did it come today?
No.
Mailbox at the end of my drive.
Supervisor Pritchard called me, or I spoke with him this morning, and it wasn't mailed until Friday, according to him.
I got that.
But I think this does represent, you know, to give you guys an idea, whenever there's a controversial issue, what I've noticed is you have a lot of, besides you all, you have a lot of outside groups, organizations, levels of government call in, and they may have, very seldom do they say, we just want more information. It's usually we're for it or against it, and they want, you know, and they're, you know, they don't like the way it's going, then they call somebody else. And I'm not saying this is the case with this, but it gives you an idea that what we tend to do is say, you know what, that's a very important thought you have or whatever. Come to the meetings, view it on the video, get the information that's been presented to you, because what we don't want is a lot of information going to every different organization, and it may be different than what you've heard. Because then when they come back here and they, you know, present it to you in a way, it kind of feels like, whoa, staff didn't tell us that. So it is important that what we say is unified and consistent and not a practice of, let's, you know, we don't like what they said in the Environmental Service Committee, let's get somebody to our meeting so we can, you know, get something else and go to another committee or come back and say, hey, you know, you're wrong. So we try to keep it consistent. And I haven't read this letter yet, but I suspect that's what I had to do.
And, okay, then we got a deal that's coming up on the 24th at the Unity High School auditorium. Right to arm? Did you get those?
I just got, yeah, I did just read that letter this morning.
Did you say right to harm?
Yes.
Yeah.
Not right to farm?
Harm.
Harm.
Yeah, H-A-R-M.
You haven't got this one either?
No, can I take a peek?
My goodness gracious, you're bringing stuff up. Do you come to work? Or do you just come to this room? We've all gotten. I got this one last week.
Yeah, I got it a while ago.
So that's up to.
Maybe it's only my supervisors.
Yeah, we all got it on the mail.
Yeah, but it might have just been supervisors. It might not have been the staff. I think they're gonna talk about municipal overflows.
Exciting.
Yeah.
You guest speaker.
Somebody else, I'm gonna probably.
Yeah.
Probably.
I'll take it.
All right. Go for it, Jim.
I have a motion to adjourn.
I'll second. Jim says I have to second. All those in favor?
Motion.